wish I wasn't me. Sometimes I wish I was drug free. Sometimes wish I saw the exit sign first. Sometimes wish I knew the truth without search. Sometimes I wish I could go where I never been, see what I never saw, do what I never did. So red sometimes. I wish I had breakfast in bed sometimes. I mean, it's worth it since I did all the work last night. Sometimes you ain't good to me. Yes, I am good to you. You should be nicer than you are sometimes. You take that complaining shit way too far. I mean, I thought it was cute in the beginning, but now I think you only do it 'cause you know I hate it sometimes. Training sometime, then it wouldn't hurt me so bad. When I dream of knocking you in your head, then it wouldn't hurt me so bad. When I reason I put up your ass sometime. Wish I knew life with no.
Man, that's a bad cut, man. Real talk, that's a bad cut. Cracking, y'all. I'm GG. You tuned into the Green Gorilla Channel. It's the place where black men can express themselves freely, straight up, with no chasers, man. Real talk. First things first, man. Shout out to all the haters out there. I know y'all hate watching, man. Have a good one, man. If you're coming in, man, make sure to like the video. If you haven't subscribed to the channel already, subscribe, man. I'm trying to get to 10,000, man, by next month, man. Can I get to 10,000 by next month, man? Come on, man. Help your boy out, man. And one of the ways you can do that is
share the damn video, bitch.
Share the video, man. Share the video, man. And if you haven't subscribed to the Green Gorilla Channel, go ahead and do that, man, so I can go ahead and get to 10 G's, man. Push me over the top, man. Anyway, as I always do, I want to give some accolades to the people who are actually, you know, have made a commitment to help support me, man. So shout out to Red Falls Black, Electrician 480, Sherlin Woe, Black Conscious Black Honey, Broken Blade, Brotherly Love, excuse me, Be Conscious Black Honey. Let me get that right. Broken Blade, Brotherly Love, Inherently Enthusiastic, or Intuitive, rather. Shadow Observer, Stefan and Jazz Tech. I'm stammering and stubborn. Stammering and stumbling. FA4L Andre, Damian H, J. Cleveland Green, Black Men Being Brutally Honest, Binga, Gerard Sheldon, Hostile Adep, Timothy Blewett, Dardar, An Honest Look at the End, and Roderick Jackson. Big up. Big up to Cutting Up with the Jones, Boy B. Free, Zanko, Cornelius Bellamy, Salty Balls, Mike Johnston, No Sleep, Tell Toya, Divine Love Ridge, Timothy Blewett, and Wild Bear. Big up. Big up, Son, Rob Arnolis, BGS Ibmore, Mantis on Break, Lock Vegas, Bimrock, Passport OG, Rasheed Barnes, Blacksword 404, Leon 008, and Artisan MC. Big up. Big up, Dub Will, Mr. Good Dad, Third Coast X, Michael Ross, 63rd Samurai, Ismail Shamad, The Watcher, The Ruthless Heartless Revelator, Kill the Game, Dr. Thunder, and Jason Hills. Big up. Big up Charles Finney, Interesting Thought, The Silent Warrior, Naomi Gary, The Toxic Black Masculine, The Black Toxic Masculinist, Seek Truth, Larry R, Seth Sun, Afro Troop TV, Show Me, and Spain Man. Big up. Seventh Coast Dojo, Anthony Davis, I'm Just Jules, Ricky Dawson, Truth 7360, Mr. Me Too, Call for President, Gold Professor, AKs and Curtains in H-Town. Big up. Big up Roguish. Big up Adrian Thomas, D. Scott, Path God, Pete Rock, Aaron Peters, Vince Lindsay, Quiz the Poet, Black Wizard, ADOS, Troy Warren, and Mrs. K.P. Bailey. Big up. Big up Alan Wiley, The Face, Life of Commerce, AI Apostle, Jeffrey Speed, Marvin Battle Jr., Adam Ignatz Mouse, Dr. Tree 33, and 77 BaseX. But shout out to Brian McMurray, Cameron S., and Charles Rogers. Shout out to Rick Ross, Charles Gilmore, Greg Barry Little, Mr. Valentino, Dr. Rock, Mark Swift, Odd Collar, Donald Watts, Coach Hotep, Mr. Blue Collar, TD Hip Hop Media, Drew Main, Mr. Heat, Sir Anthony, MLR, Universal 178, Aaron Smith, DHA Double, Kalonja Collar, and WPR1, man. Big up to all y'all. And then on the Patreon side, man, big up to Frank Black, Robert Wicks, Chris Flowers, Christopher Burton, Daxby the Tetrahedron, Jay Live, Keith Bass Jr., Nick, Albert C., Dr. Ben Vincent, Waffle Weave, Darnell Smith, Excalibur, Pursuer Prisoner, Taz, Dragon 59, Jay Bailey, Momal, and Asangua. And can't forget the brothers in the Ethereal Plane, David Carroll, Force Windu, and Kevin Samuels, man. Big up, man. Y'all deserve a round of applause, of course. You know you do. Thank you so much for helping me to keep this boat afloat, man, and keep the thing moving. And if you're wondering how you can help the Green Gorilla channel on an ongoing basis, man, you can do so by becoming a member either on Patreon or on YouTube, man. It's just that simple, man. Push your boy to 10,000, man. I'll be back.
What's good, everybody? I'm the G with a PhD, and you're tuned in to the Green Gorilla channel, the place where black men can express themselves freely, straight up, no chaser. Today, I want to introduce you to my new membership program that consists of 5 levels where you can invest in the Green Gorilla channel on a monthly basis and receive level-specific perks. Memberships are special because they improve the quality of the content of the channel and will help me to be able to keep the channel going. Now, to participate in the Green Gorilla channel membership program, all you have to do is hit the join button, which is located right next to the subscribe button on my channel page. Now, for all of my subscribers who decide not to participate in my membership program, nothing will change. The content will keep coming the way it always has. Thanks for watching, and be careful out here, people. Bless.
All right, we back, man. I'm GG. You tuned in to the Green Gorilla channel, man. Shout out to Man Friday. Appreciate that, man. The man them across the pond them. He put $5 in the pot. So, well, 5 pounds. That's 5 pounds, isn't it? It ain't just $5. That's 5 pounds. So, shout out to that brother over there. And every time I see his... your logo, man, it reminds me of Mantronics, man. I was listening to some Mantronics last night, bro. This is what I was listening to. Could y'all hear that? Y'all put a 1 if y'all can hear that, man. That's Mantronics right there, man. Can you hear that, man? Or maybe it's not coming through. I'm not sure if it was coming through or not, man. Put a 1 out there if you can hear that, man. That's Mantronics, bro. Hey, man, if you ain't old school, you don't know about Mantronics. That's Mantronics, boy. Look, I was a big Mantronics fan back in the day, man. You feel me? Fresh is the word. Mantronics is the crew. You know what I'm saying? Baseline, Get Stupid Fresh. Boy, man, I'm telling you, man, I was a big Mantronics fan. I had all their records. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, shout out to David White, man. Appreciate that donation, bro. Really, straight up, man. Word to the strength, man. Straight up, man. Thank you so much, man. Appreciate that. You deserve some fanfare for that one, man. Appreciate that, bro. Appreciate that. Appreciate that, man. Appreciate that. Thank you. Says from the official sponsor of the G with the PhD, Black Men. Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. Straight up. Hey, ladies was the one you like? Yeah, man. I remember that. So sweet, so sad, so something with the never come see you. My, I don't know the words to it, but I know the melody to it. To all the ladies, if you think you're down, all the ladies. We can go cruising all around the town. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, Get Stupid was my joint too. Yeah. So anyway, man, look. Today we're going to finish up talking about Kimberly Crenshaw's article, Race Reform and Retrenchment. I've already read sections 1, 2, and 3. This will be sections 4 and 5. And for the most part, man, you know, like, this will become important in further conversations that I have on this channel, you know, in the future. But I still have more terrain to cover because there's 3 articles that she wrote that I think are important. Now, this first article doesn't talk about the intersection of race and gender. It just talks about race and anti-discrimination law. Okay. And it criticizes the left and the right. Okay. And then in the end, she offers what she considers to be a viable solution, right? Kind of like a cohesiveness and a consciousness, a collective consciousness within the Black community. And then, you know, this begs the question, what happened? You know? What happened to the idea of a collective consciousness? But having said all that, I think we'll just jump right into it. I don't want to delay too much. I want to get through this and then leave y'all to y'all own devices. But so in that spirit, let me get this show on the road, man. And I'll, you know, for the most part, be quiet while this is taking place. But I will scroll the text as, you know, I read this off. So let's go, man.
Today, we're diving into the fourth and final sections of Kimberly Crenshaw's seminal article, Race, Reform and Retrenchment, Transformation and Legitimation in Anti-Discrimination Law. This section unpacks the complex relationship between race consciousness, legal reforms, and the ideological frameworks that both empower and limit social change. First up, Crenshaw lays down the historical groundwork. She shows us how race consciousness has been historically manipulated to maintain social hierarchies, especially after the Reconstruction era. She argues that racism was often used as a tool to create a broader base for a new notion of democracy, even if it came at the expense of class solidarity. Moving on, she takes us into the labor movement, highlighting how race consciousness was a significant factor in the exclusion of Black workers from unions. This exclusion served as a mechanism to maintain racial hierarchies within the labor force. Fast forward to the modern era, and Crenshaw cites Ronald Reagan's presidency as a pivotal moment where race consciousness played a significant role in shaping American politics. Now let's talk about the transition from the Jim Crow era to an era of formal equality and race law. While this transition dismantled explicit forms of discrimination, it didn't eliminate the underlying race consciousness that continues to function in more covert ways. Crenshaw then critically examines the dual role of rights discourse. While it has been instrumental in dismantling formal barriers, it's also contributed to an ideological framework that makes the current conditions facing the Black underclass appear fair and reasonable. She also raises concerns about the potential loss of a collective identity among Blacks due to the different experiences of racism that various classes of African Americans now face. Finally, Crenshaw argues for a pragmatic approach that acknowledges the dual role of rights and the dominant ideology. She suggests that African Americans must engage in what she calls a self-conscious ideological struggle to navigate the complexities of race consciousness and liberal reform. So, what are the key takeaways here? Crenshaw presents a nuanced view of the role of rights discourse. While it has been a tool for progress, it also serves to legitimize existing inequalities by framing them within a narrative of formal equality. Two, she argues that race consciousness is not just a relic of the past, but continues to play a complex role in modern society, often intertwined with class consciousness. Three, she calls for a strategic engagement with the dominant ideology, acknowledging that frontal attacks may not be effective given the deeply institutionalized nature of race consciousness. Lastly, despite the fragmentation of experiences within the Black community, Crenshaw emphasizes the importance of collective action to challenge the deeply ingrained norms that perpetuate inequality. In the end, Crenshaw's work raises crucial questions about the efficacy of legal reforms and rights discourse in genuinely transforming racial hierarchies. It also challenges us to think strategically about how to navigate within a system inherently designed to maintain certain forms of inequality. Her call for a new approach that focuses on the specific needs of the African American community serves as a rallying point for future discourse and action. Section 4, the context defined. racist ideology, and hegemony. The failure of the critics to consider race in their account of law and legitimacy is not a minor oversight. Race consciousness is central not only to the domination of blacks, but also to whites' acceptance of the legitimacy of hierarchy and to their identity with elite interests. Exposing the centrality of race consciousness is crucial to identifying and delegitimating beliefs that present hierarchy as inevitable and fair. Moreover, exposing the centrality of race consciousness shows how the options of blacks in American society have been limited and how the use of rights rhetoric has emancipated blacks from some manifestations of racial domination. A realignment of the critical project to incorporate race consciousness must begin with beliefs about blacks in American society and how these beliefs legitimize racial coercion. Thus, this part examines the deep-rooted problem of racist ideology, or white race consciousness, and suggests how this form of consciousness legitimates prevailing injustices and constrains the development of new solutions that benefit Black Americans. Racist ideology provides a series of rationalizations that suppress the contradictions between American political ideals and Black existence under white supremacy. Not only does racism legitimate the oppression of Blacks, it also helps to define and privilege membership in the white community, creating a basis for identification with dominant interests. Racism serves a consensus-building hegemonic role by designating Black people as separate, visible others to be contrasted in every way with all other social groups. Although not consenting to domination, Black people are seen as legitimate objects of antipathy and coercion by whites. In the first section of this part, I examine the political and ideological dynamic of white supremacy, which I term the politics of otherness. In this part's second section, I sketch the contours of an analysis which suggests that race consciousness legitimates racial oppression. Within this framework, one can better comprehend how the assertion of rights in the context of a formal, legally sanctioned subordination created a radical challenge to the dominant order. In response to this assertion of rights, legal reforms were promulgated that transformed the Black experience by lifting formal barriers that had subordinated all Black people and produced their formal and political designation as other. The critics are correct in observing that, despite these gains, engaging in rights discourse has helped to de-radicalize and co-opt the challenge in the current period in which racial oppression continues to flourish behind the screen of racial equality. Yet, only after race ideology itself and the real differences that formal equality made in transforming race ideology are understood can the paradoxical relationship of transformation and legitimation be fully appreciated. Blacks are ultimately presented with a dilemma. Liberal reform both transforms and legitimates. Even though legal ideology absorbs, redefines, and limits the language of protest, African Americans cannot ignore the power of legal ideology to counter some of the most repressive aspects of racial domination. Subsection A, the hegemonic role of racism, establishing the other in American ideology. Throughout American history, the subordination of Black types and beliefs that made their conditions appear logical and natural. Historically, white supremacy has been premised upon various political, scientific, and religious theories, each of which relies on racial characterizations and stereotypes about Blacks that have coalesced into an extensive legitimating ideology. Today, it is probably not controversial to say that these stereotypes were developed primarily to rationalize the oppression of Blacks. What is overlooked, however, is the extent to which these stereotypes serve a hegemonic function by perpetuating a mythology about both Blacks and whites even today, reinforcing an illusion of a white community that cuts across ethnic, gender, and class lines. As presented by critical scholars, hegemonic rule succeeds to the extent that the ruling class worldview establishes the appearance of a unity of interest between the dominant class and the dominated. Throughout American history, racism has identified the interest of subordinated whites with those of society's white elite. Racism does not support the dominant order simply because all whites want to maintain their privilege at the expense of blacks, or because blacks sometimes serve as convenient political scapegoats. Instead, the very existence of a clearly subordinated other group is contrasted with the norm in a way that reinforces identification with the dominant group. Racism helps create an illusion of unity through the oppositional force of a symbolic other. The establishment of an other creates a bond, a burgeoning common identity of all non-stigmatized parties, whose identity and interest are defined in opposition to the other. According to the philosophy of Jacques Derrida, a structure of polarized categories is characteristic of Western thought. Western thought has always been structured in terms of dichotomies or polarities. Good versus evil, being versus nothingness, presence versus absence, truth versus error, identity versus difference, mind versus matter, man versus woman, soul versus body, life versus death, nature versus culture, speech versus writing. These polar opposites do not, however, stand as independent and equal entities. The second term in each undesirable version of the first, a fall away from it. In other words, the two terms are not simply opposed in their meanings, but are arranged in a hierarchical order which gives the first term priority. Racist ideology replicates this pattern of arranging oppositional categories in a hierarchical order. Historically, whites represented the dominant antinomy, while blacks came to be seen as separate and subordinate. This hierarchy is reflected in the chart below. Note how each traditional negative image of blacks correlates with a counter image of whites. Reading of the chart, historical oppositional dualities. White images, black images. White image, industrious. Black image, lazy. White image, intelligent. Black image, unintelligent. White, moral. Black, immoral. White, knowledgeable. Black, ignorant. White, enabling culture. Black, disabling culture. White, law-abiding. Black, criminal. White, responsible. Black, shiftless. White, virtuous, pious. Black, lascivious. The oppositional dynamic symbolized by this chart was created and maintained through an elaborate and systematic process. Laws and customs help create races out of a broad range of human traits. In the process of creating races, the categories came to be filled with meaning. Blacks were characterized one way, whites another. Whites became associated with normatively positive characteristics. Blacks became associated with the subordinate, even aberrational characteristics. The operation of this dynamic, along with the important political role of racial oppositionalism, can be illustrated through a few brief historical references. Edmund Morgan provides vivid illustration of how slaveholders from the 17th century onward created and politicized racial categories to maintain the support of non-slaveholding whites. Morgan recounts how the planters lumped Indians, mulattoes, and Negroes in a single slave class, and how these categories became an essential, if unacknowledged, ingredient in the Republican ideology that enabled Virginians to lead the nation. Having accepted a common interest with slaveholders in keeping blacks subordinated, even whites who had material reasons to object to the dominance over the slaveholding class could challenge the regime only so far. The power of race consciousness convinced whites to support a system that was opposed to their own economic interests. As George Frederickson puts it, racial privilege could and did serve as a compensation for class disadvantage. Domination through race consciousness continued throughout the post-Reconstruction period. Historian C. Van Woodward has argued that the ruling plantocracy was able to undermine the progressive accomplishments of the populist movement by stirring up anti-black sentiment among poor white farmers. Racism was articulated as the broader ground for a new democracy. As racism formed the new base for a broader notion of democracy, class differences were mediated through reference to a racial community of equality. A tragic example of the success of such race-conscious political manipulation is the career of Tom Watson, leader of the progressive populist movement of the 1890s. Watson, in his attempts to educate the masses of poor farmers about the destructive role of race-based politics, repeatedly told black and white audiences, "You are made to hate each other because upon that hatred is rested the keystone of the arch of financial despotism which enslaves you both. You are deceived and blinded that you may not see how this race antagonism perpetuates a monetary system which beggars you both." Yet, by 1906, Watson had joined the movement to disenfranchise blacks. According to Woodward, Watson had persuaded himself that only after the Negro was eliminated from politics could populist principles gain a hearing. In other words, the white men would have to unite before they could divide. White race consciousness also played a role in the nascent labor movement in the North. Labor historian Herbert Hill has demonstrated that unions of virtually all trades excluded black workers from their ranks, often entirely barring black employment in certain fields. Immigrant labor unions were particularly adamant about keeping out black workers. Indeed, it was for the precise purpose of assimilating into the American mainstream that immigrant laborers adopted these exclusionary policies. The political and ideological role that race consciousness continues to play is suggested by racial polarization in contemporary presidential politics. Several political commentators have suggested that many whites supported Ronald Reagan in the belief that he would correct a perceived policy imbalance that unjustly benefited blacks. And some argue further that Reagan made a direct racist appeal to white voters. Manning Marable notes, for example, that appeals to the race consciousness of white workers were the decisive factor in Reagan's 1984 victory, especially in the South. Reagan received nearly 70% of the white vote, whereas 90% of black voters cast their ballots for Mondale. Similarly, the vast majority of blacks, 82%, disapproved of Reagan's performance, whereas only 32% of whites did. Even the Democratic Party, which has traditionally relied upon blacks as its most loyal constituency, has responded to this apparent racial polarization by seeking to distance itself from black interests. Although it has been argued that the racial polarization demonstrated in the 1984 election does not represent a trend of white defections from the Democratic Party, it is significant that, whatever the cause of the party's inability to attract white votes, Democratic leaders have expressed a willingness to moderate the party's stand on key racial issues in attempts to recapture the white vote. Subsection B, the role of race consciousness in a system of formal equality. The previous section emphasizes the continuity of white race consciousness over the course of American history. This section, by contrast, focuses on the partial transformation of the functioning of race consciousness that occurred with the transition from Jim Crow to formal equality in race law. Prior to the civil rights reforms, blacks were formally subordinated by the state. Blacks experienced being the other in two aspects of oppression, which I shall designate as symbolic and material. Symbolic subordination refers to the formal denial of social and political equality to all blacks, regardless of their accomplishments. Segregation and other forms of social exclusion, separate restrooms, drinking fountains, entrances, parks, cemeteries, and dining facilities, reinforced a racist ideology that blacks were simply inferior to whites and were therefore not included in the vision of America as a community of equals. Material subordination, on the other hand, refers to the ways that discrimination and exclusion economically subordinated blacks to whites and subordinated the life chances of blacks to those of whites on almost every level. This subordination occurs when blacks are paid less for the same work, when segregation limits access to decent housing, and where poverty, anxiety, poor health care, and crime create a life expectancy for blacks that is 5 to 6 years shorter than for whites. Symbolic subordination often created material disadvantage by reinforcing race consciousness in everything from employment to education. In fact, the two are generally not thought of separately. Separate facilities were usually inferior facilities, and limited job categorization virtually always brought lower pay and harder work. Despite the pervasiveness of racism, however, there existed even before the civil rights movement a class of blacks who were educationally, economically, and professionally equal, if not superior, to many whites. And yet these blacks suffered social and political exclusion as well. It is also significant that not all separation resulted in inferior institutions. School segregation, although often presented as the epitome of symbolic and material subordination, did not always result in inferior education. It is not separation per se that made segregation subordinating, but the fact that it was enforced and supported by state power and accompanied by the explicit belief in African American inferiority. The response to the civil rights movement was the removal of most formal barriers and symbolic manifestations of subordination. Thus, white-only notices and other obvious indicators of the societal policy of racial subordination disappeared, at least in the public sphere. The disappearance of these symbols and subordination reflected the acceptance of the rhetoric of formal equality and signaled the demise of the rhetoric of white supremacy as expressing America's normative vision. In other words, it could no longer be said that blacks were not included as equals in the American political vision. Removal of these public manifestations of subordination was a significant gain for all blacks, although some benefited more than others. The eradication of formal barriers meant more to those whose oppression was primarily symbolic than to those who suffered long-lasting material disadvantage. Yet, despite these disparate results, it would be absurd to suggest that no benefits came from these formal reforms, especially in regard to racial policies such as segregation that were partly material but largely symbolic. Thus, to say that the reforms were merely symbolic is to say a great deal. These legal reforms and the formal extension of citizenship were large achievements precisely because much of what characterized black oppression was symbolic and formal. Yet the attainment of formal equality is not the end of the story. Racial hierarchy cannot be cured by the move to facial race neutrality in the laws that structured the economic, political, and social lives of black people. White race consciousness, in a new form, but still virulent, plays an important, perhaps crucial role in the new regime that has legitimated the deteriorating day-to-day material conditions of the majority of blacks. The end of Jim Crow has been accompanied by the demise of an explicit ideology of white supremacy. The white norm, however, has not disappeared. It has only been submerged in popular consciousness. It continues in an unspoken form as a statement of the positive social norm, legitimating the continuing domination of those who do not meet it. Nor have the negative stereotypes associated with blacks been eradicated. The rationalizations once used to legitimate black subordination based on a belief in racial inferiority have now been re-employed to legitimate the domination of blacks through reference to an assumed cultural inferiority. Thomas Sowell, for example, suggests that underclass blacks are economically depressed because they have not adopted the values of hard work and discipline. He further implies that blacks have not pursued the need to attain skills and marketable education and have not learned to make sacrifices necessary for success. Instead, Sowell charges that blacks view demands for special treatment as a means for achieving what other groups have achieved through hard work and the abandonment of racial politics. Soul applies the same stereotypes to the mass of blacks that white supremacists had applied in the past, but bases these modern stereotypes on notions of culture rather than genetics. Soul characterizes underclass blacks as victims of self-imposed ignorance, lack of direction, and poor work attitudes. Culture, not race, now accounts for this otherness. Except for vestigial pockets of historical racism, any possible connection between past racial subordination and the present situation has been severed by the formal repudiation of the old race-conscious policies. The same dualities historically used to legitimate racial subordination in the name of genetic inferiority have now been adopted by Sowell as a means for explaining the subordinated status of blacks today in terms of cultural inferiority. Moreover, Sowell's explanation of the subordinate status of blacks also illustrates the treatment of the now unspoken white stereotypes as the positive social norm. His assertion that the absence of certain attributes accounts for the continued subordination of blacks implies that it is the presence of these attributes that explains. The only difference between this argument and the older oppositional dynamic is that whereas the latter explained black subordination through reference to the ideology of white supremacy, the former explains black subordination through reference to an unspoken social norm. That norm, although no longer explicitly white supremacist, remains, nonetheless, a white norm. As Martha Minow has pointed out, the unstated point of comparison is not neutral, but particular, and not inevitable, but only seemingly so when left unstated. White race consciousness, which includes the modern belief in cultural inferiority, acts to further black subordination by justifying all the forms of unofficial racial discrimination, injury, and neglect that flourish in a society that is only formally dedicated to equality. In more subtle ways, moreover, white race consciousness reinforces and is reinforced by the myth of equal opportunity that explains and justifies broader class hierarchies. Race consciousness also reinforces whites' sense that American society is really meritocratic and thus helps prevent them from questioning the basic legitimacy of the free market, believing both that blacks are inferior and that the economy impartially rewards the superior over the inferior. Whites see that most blacks are indeed worse off than whites are, which reinforces their sense that the market is operating fairly and impartially. Those who should logically be on the bottom are on the bottom. This strengthening of whites' belief in the system in turn reinforces their beliefs that blacks are indeed inferior. After all, equal opportunity is the rule, and the market is an impartial judge. If blacks are on the bottom, it must reflect their relative inferiority. Racist ideology thus operates in conjunction with the class components of legal ideology to reinforce the status quo, both in terms of class and race. To bring a fundamental challenge to the way things are, whites would have to question not just their own subordinate status, but also both the economic and the racial myths that justify the status quo. Racism, combined with equal opportunity mythology, provides a rationalization for racial oppression, making it difficult for whites to see the black situation as illegitimate or unnecessary. If whites believe that blacks, because they are unambitious or inferior, get what they deserve, it becomes that much harder to convince whites that something is wrong with the entire system. Similarly, a challenge to the legitimacy of continued racial inequality would force whites to confront myths about equality of opportunity that justify for them whatever measure of economic success they may have attained. Thus, although critics have suggested that legal consciousness plays a central role in legitimating hierarchy in America, the otherness dynamic enthroned within the maintenance and perpetuation of white race consciousness seems to be at least as important as legal consciousness in supporting the dominant order. Like legal consciousness, race consciousness makes it difficult, at least for whites, to imagine the world differently. It also creates the desire for identification with privileged elites. By focusing on a distinct, subordinate other, whites can include themselves in the dominant circle, an arena in which most hold no real power, but only their privileged racial identity. Consider the case of a dirt poor Southern white shown participating in a Ku Klux Klan rally in the movie Resurgence, who declared, "Every morning I wake up and thank God I'm white." For this person, and for others like him, race consciousness, manifested by his refusal even to associate with blacks, provides a powerful explanation of why he fails to challenge the current social order. Subsection C, rights discourse as a challenge to the oppositional dynamic. The oppositional dynamic, premised upon maintaining blacks as an excluded and subordinated other, initially created an ideological and political structure of formal inequality against which rights rhetoric proved to be the most effective weapon. Although rights rhetoric may ultimately have absorbed the civil rights challenge and legitimated continued subordination, the otherness dynamic provides a fuller understanding of how the very transformation afforded by legal reform itself has contributed to the ideological and political legitimation of continuing black subordination. Rights discourse provided the ideological mechanisms through which the conflicts of federalism, the power of the presidency, and the legitimacy of the courts could be orchestrated against Jim Crow. Movement leaders used these tactics to force open a conflict between whites that eventually benefited black people. Casting racial issues in the moral and legal rights rhetoric of the prevailing ideology helped create the political controversy without which the state's coercive function would not have been enlisted to aid blacks. Simply critiquing the ideology from without or making demands in language outside the rights discourse would have accomplished little. Rather, blacks gained by using a powerful combination of direct action, mass protest, and individual acts of resistance, along with appeals to public opinion and the courts couched in the language of the prevailing legal consciousness. The result was a series of ideological and political crises. In these crises, civil rights activists and lawyers induced the federal government to aid blacks and triggered efforts to legitimate and reinforce the authority of the law in ways that benefited blacks. Simply insisting that blacks be integrated or speaking in the language of needs would have endangered the lives of those who were already taking risks and with no reasonable chance of success. President Eisenhower, for example, would not have sent federal troops to Little Rock simply at the behest of protesters demanding that black school children receive an equal education. Instead, the successful manipulation of legal rhetoric led to a crisis of federal power that ultimately benefited blacks. Some critics of legal reform movements seem to overlook the fact that state power has made a significant difference, sometimes between life and death, in the efforts of black people to transform their world. Attempts to harness the power of the state through the appropriate rhetorical legal incantations should be appreciated as intensely powerful and calculated political acts. In the context of white supremacy, engaging in rights discourse should be seen as an act of self-defense. This was particularly true because the state could not assume a position of neutrality regarding black people once the movement had mobilized people to challenge the system of oppression. Either the coercive mechanism of the state had to be used to support white supremacy, or it had to be used to dismantle it. We now know, with hindsight, that it did both. Blacks did use rights rhetoric to mobilize state power to their benefit against symbolic oppression through formal inequality and, to some extent, against material deprivation in the form of private, informal exclusion of the middle class from jobs and housing. Yet today, the same legal reforms play a role in providing an ideological framework that makes the present conditions facing underclass blacks appear fair and reasonable. The eradication of barriers has created a new dilemma for those victims of racial oppression who are not in a position to benefit from the move to formal equality. The race neutrality of the legal system creates the illusion that racism is no longer the primary factor responsible for the condition of the black underclass. Instead, as we have seen, class disparities appear to be the consequence of individual and group merit within a supposed system of equal opportunity. Moreover, the fact that there are blacks who are economically successful gives credence both to the assertion that opportunities exist and to the backlash attitude that blacks have gotten too far. Psychologically, for blacks who have not made it, the lack of an explanation for their underclass status may result in self-blame and other self-destructive attitudes. Another consequence of the formal reforms may be the loss of collectivity among blacks. The removal of former barriers created new opportunities for some blacks that were not shared by various other classes of African Americans. As blacks moved into different spheres, the experience of being black in America became fragmented and multifaceted, and the different contexts presented opportunities to experience racism in different ways. The social, economic, even residential distance between the various classes may complicate efforts to unite behind issues as a racial group. Although white-only signs may have been crude and debilitating, they at least presented a readily discernible target around which to organize. Now the targets are obscure and diffuse, and this difference may create doubt among some blacks whether there is enough similarity between their life experiences and those of other blacks to warrant collective political action. Formal equality significantly transformed the black experience in America. With society's embrace of formal equality came the eradication of symbolic domination and the suppression of white supremacy as the norm of society. Future generations of black Americans would no longer be explicitly regarded as America's second-class citizens. Yet, the transformation of the oppositional dynamic, achieved through the suppression of racial norms and stereotypes, and the recasting of racial inferiority into assumptions of cultural inferiority, creates several difficulties for the civil rights constituency. The removal of formal barriers, although symbolically significant to all and materially significant to some, will do little to alter the hierarchical relationship between blacks and whites until the way in which white race consciousness perpetuates norms that legitimate black subordination is revealed. This is not to say that white norms alone account for the conditions of the black underclass. It is instead an acknowledgement that until the distinct racial nature of class ideology is itself revealed and debunked, nothing can be done about the underlying structural problems that account for the disparities. The narrow focus of racial exclusion, that is, the belief that racial exclusion is illegitimate only where the white-only signs are explicit, coupled with strong assumptions about equal opportunity, makes it difficult to move the discussion of racism beyond the societal self-satisfaction engendered by the appearance of neutral norms and formal inclusion. Subsection D, self-consciousness, ideological struggle. Rights have been important. They may have legitimated racial inequality, but they also have been the means by which oppressed groups have secured both entry as formal equals into the dominant order and the survival of their movement in the face of private and state repression. The dual role of legal change creates a dilemma for black reformers. As long as race consciousness thrives, blacks will often have to rely on rights rhetoric when it is necessary to protect black interests. The very reforms brought about by appeals to legal ideology, however, seem to undermine the ability to move forward toward a broader vision of racial equality. In the quest for racial justice, winning and losing have been part of the same experience. The critics are correct in observing that engaging in rights discourse has helped to de-radicalize and co-opt the challenge. Yet they fail to acknowledge the limited range of options presented to blacks in a context where they were deemed other, and the unlikelihood that specific demands for inclusion and equality would be heard if articulated in other terms. This abbreviated list of options is itself contingent upon the ideological power of white race consciousness and the continuing role of black Americans as other. Future efforts to address racial domination, as well as class hierarchy, must consider the continuing ideology of white race consciousness by uncovering the oppositional dynamic and by chipping away at its premises. Central to this task is revealing the contingency of race and exploring the connection between white race consciousness and other myths that legitimate both class and race hierarchies. Critics and others whose agendas include challenging hierarchy and legitimation must not overlook the importance of revealing the contingency of race. Optimally, the deconstruction of white race consciousness might lead to a liberated future for both blacks and whites. Yet, until whites recognize the hegemonic function of racism and turn their efforts toward neutralizing it, African-American people must develop pragmatic political strategies, self-conscious ideological struggle to minimize the cost of liberal reform while maximizing its utility. A primary step in engaging in self-conscious ideological struggle must be to transcend the oppositional dynamic in which blacks are cast simply and solely as whites' subordinate other. The dual role that whites have played makes strategizing a difficult task. Black people can afford neither to resign themselves to nor attack frontally the legitimacy and incoherence of the dominant ideology. The subordinate position of blacks in this society makes it unlikely that African Americans will realize gains through the kind of direct challenge to the legitimacy of American liberal ideology that is now being waged by critical scholars. On the other hand, delegitimating race consciousness would be directly relevant to black needs, and this strategy will sometimes require the pragmatic use of liberal ideology. This vision is consistent with the views forwarded by theoreticians such as Francis Fox Piven and Richard Cloward, Antonio Gramsci, and Roberto Unger. Piven and Cloward observe that oppressed people sometimes advance by creating ideological and political crises, but that the form of the crisis-producing challenge must reflect the institutional logic of the system. The use of rights rhetoric during the civil rights movement created such a crisis by presenting and manipulating the dominant ideology in a new and transformative way. Challenges and demands made from outside the institutional logic would have accomplished little because blacks, as the subordinate other, were already perceived as being outside the mainstream. The struggle of blacks, like that of all subordinated groups, is a struggle for inclusion, an attempt to manipulate elements of the dominant ideology to transform the experience of domination. It is a struggle to create a new status quo through the ideological and political tools that are available. Gramsci called this struggle a war of position, and he regarded it as the most appropriate strategy for change in Western societies. According to Gramsci, direct challenges to the dominant class accomplish little if ideology plays such a central role in establishing authority that the legitimacy of the dominant regime is not challenged. Joseph Femia, interpreting Gramsci, states that the dominant ideology in modern capitalist societies is highly institutionalized and widely internalized. It follows that a concentration on frontal attack, on direct assault against the bourgeois state, war of movement or war of maneuver, can result only in disappointment and defeat. Consequently, the challenge in such societies is to create a counter-hegemony by maneuvering within and expanding the dominant ideology to embrace the potential for change. Gramsci's vision of ideological struggle is echoed in part by Roberto Unger in his vision of deviationist doctrine. Unger, who represents another discarding liberal legal ideology, we should focus and develop its visionary undercurrents. The struggle over the form of social life through deviationist doctrine creates opportunities for experimental revisions of social life in the direction of the ideals we defend. An implication of our ideas is that the elements of a formative institutional or imaginative structure may be replaced piecemeal rather than only all at once. Liberal ideology embraces communal and liberating visions along with the legitimating hegemonic visions. Unger, like Gramsci and Piven and Cloward, seems to suggest that the strategy towards meaningful change depends on skillful use of the liberating potential of dominant ideology. Section 5, conclusion. For blacks, the task at hand is to devise ways to wage ideological and political struggle while minimizing the cost of engaging in an inherently legitimating discourse.
a clearer understanding of the space we occupy in the American political consciousness is a necessary prerequisite to the development of pragmatic strategies for political and economic survival. In this regard, the most serious challenge for Blacks is to minimize the political and cultural cost of engaging in an inevitably co-optive process in order to secure material benefits. Because our present predicament gives us few options, we must create conditions for the maintenance of a distinct political thought that is informed by the actual conditions of Black people. Unlike the civil rights vision, this new approach should not be defined and therefore limited by the possibilities of dominant political discourse, but should maintain a distinctly progressive outlook that focuses on the needs of the African American community. The end.
All right, so that's it. And what I'm going to do is take a quick break and then I'll entertain some comments or maybe some questions. So I'll be right back. All right, man, I'm back. I know that was kind of painful. I get it. I understand it. I mean, this is an academic article written by a law professor, man, and it wasn't speaking to the lay public. It's speaking to other people who are engaged in the same profession she is. You know, kind of like a priestly class of professionals who speak in a, you know, a language that only they understand. Now, you know, my whole goal is to make this intelligible to you. You know, so that you could actually understand, you know, the development of this woman's thought, because she is, you know, the person who coined the phrase intersectionality. Now, one could argue there were precursors to the whole notion of intersectionality. I've taken feminist courses, so I understand that the Combahee River Collective was a precursor to intersectionality because they talk about class, they talk about sex, they talk about sexuality. And they also talk about race. So, you know, to them, there's four components, right? And Barbara Smith was one of the, you know, the architects or the founders of the Combahee River Collective. Some people say that you can find elements of intersectionality, you know, a kind of unintelligible uttering of people who were members of the suffragette movement, you know, like, for example, Sojourner Truth or something like that. But, I mean, ultimately, Kimberlé Crenshaw is the person who coins the phrase intersectionality and etches into the popular consciousness what that concept actually means and what it entails, okay? So if anybody is going to be responsible for, you know, bringing this way of thinking to the fore in a formal and in an officially articulate way, it's going to be Kimberlé Crenshaw, not anybody else. Although, again, one could argue that there are precursors and people who kind of, you know, set out the rudiments of what this would eventually become. But as you can see in this article, Kimberlé Crenshaw spends no time mentioning race, class, and gender. She just, I mean, there's a reference to it. If you catch it, I have to dig through this paper, but I did underline it or highlight it. When she made a reference to it, she says something about race, class, but she doesn't say gender. She says something else. I'm looking for it now to see if I can find it really quickly. But let me, if anybody has any questions they want to ask, they can ask them. Hold on, let me see. V. I'm looking for that point where she makes mention of this notion of class and sex and shit like that. Hold on. And it would just be my luck that I would bury it. Just my luck that I would bury it, because I highlighted too much. I do have a tendency to highlight too much, because everything becomes important, and when it does, nothing becomes important anymore when you do that. But that's just a habit of mine, and I apologize for it. I hope it wasn't too distracting while I was doing this. I'm looking for it. I'm digging through the text right now, try to find out where she makes a reference. Sex, race. Damn, I can't find it, man. It says Control F. Yeah, I get it. But I mean, race. It's kind of difficult when you got like a document that's like a mimeograph copy or something, as opposed to And then I don't know exactly how she articulated, you know, the concept. I don't know the exact phrase she used. But I mean, at the end of the day, let me break this down like in ordinary language. All right, so here are the key themes of this paper to me. The rights discourse. So, I mean, basically talking about rights. Now, of course, this woman is a legal scholar. So she's trying to justify, I think, this is personal, okay? Here's a woman who is a specialist in anti-discrimination law. And I would argue that she is someone who defends the actions of the people who participated in the civil rights movement. Now, you got people on the left who are critical legal scholars, and they're saying that, you know, rights rhetoric needs to be trashed because it doesn't uncover ideology that keeps people stuck in a pattern of thought that makes them think that any changes to the system are impossible. Because, I mean, you know, the critical legal scholars are going to say, like, the world we live in is one out of which there was, like, an endless amount of possibilities. The fact that we stumbled onto this way of life, you know, in terms of politics, economics, social arrangement, is not determinant. Things don't have to be the way that they are. Things could be different. But people, you know, often don't think outside of the box. They become canalized in terms of their thinking and, you know, their opinions about matters and issues to the point where they don't even challenge, you know, what has become rigid and perceived as, like, you know, natural or whatever the case may be. Okay. So anyway, she says the rights discourse has a dual function. Okay. So on one hand, rights discourse is a tool for liberation if, you know, operated with in the right hands. Okay. But it's also a mechanism for co-optation. It's easy for you to be co-opted using this discourse, the discourse of rights, particularly civil rights, okay? So it's been instrumental, and I'm gonna get to you, Rogish. I see you there, It's instrumental, rights rhetoric is, in dismantling formal barriers, but it's contributed to what she calls an illusion of a post-racial society, which makes it more difficult to address systemic or structural barriers to racial progress. Okay. Also, what she's saying is there's an ideological struggle that's taking place here. Okay. So what she's advocating for is this nuanced, pragmatic approach to ideological struggle. So it draws on Gramsci, which some people don't like. They say he's a Marxist. I have no problem with Gramsci. Okay. Francis Fox Piven and Cloward, they wrote a book on social movements, and Robert Unger, who suggest that African Americans could or should operate within the dominant ideology, because if you operate outside of the context of it, what type of persuasive real estate are you going to be able to grab, or how much movement towards progress are you going to be able to make if you're not even using the nomenclature that the society itself has basically, you know, absorbed and indoctrinated itself into thinking is something that's natural. Like, you have to be able to use, I mean, to borrow a term from a feminist, you got to be able to use the master's tools against them. You got to be able to take, I don't know, like, I don't watch, like, a lot of anime or shit, but I would assume that it's like if somebody throws a power bolt, it's like playing judo. You have to use the opponent's force against them. And in this instance, it's ideological force as opposed to mere physical force, right? You have to use their own political ideology against them and to demonstrate that there's contradictions in the way that they flesh out in the real world their own, you know, political ideals. Okay? And there's also this challenge, I think, of solidarity or coherence, because the text is basically pointing out it's going to be difficult to have a unified front for black folks if you got like a variety of different experiences within the black or the African-American community itself. You got class differences, you got sex differences, you have, you know, geographical differences, educational differences. There's so many different kind of differences. So it's like, okay, how do you keep a unified front in the face of those divergent experiences after the symbolic forms of discrimination have been removed? Okay. So because overt discrimination has, you know, subsided to some degree, there's a fragmentation in black experience, which complicates the way that we should move forward. Okay. And so she basically says, well, we need a new vision, a new approach that's rooted in the actual conditions and needs of the black community. But it argues for distinct political thought that's not limited by the dominant political discourse, but that's focused on community issues. Okay, so, I mean, I know that's a lot to take in, but the whole idea is the text is nuanced, okay? It's a lot there, okay? But my problem with it is that here's a woman who I think has become what she herself has cautioned against. She is a member of a movement of black elites who, to me, value recognition and visibility over the material improvement of the masses of blacks. That's just my opinion, okay? She has shifted emphasis away from collective black improvement to, I mean, what we now know are intersectional ambitions, which, by the way, I mean, she argues against being co-opted, and she argues that there's a danger of co-optation when it comes to black politics, specifically as it pertains to anti-discrimination and race rhetoric. But I mean, here's a woman who, for all intents and purposes, she's been co-opted. Like, intersectionality is the language that's utilized in corporate America in the human resources departments and in the university and in the government until, I think, you know, recently, Donald Trump came with, you know, the sex and Race Discrimination Act or something like that. I don't know what the exact name of it was called, but I call it, the witch's hammer or the malleus maleficarum, I think is what I called it. I was being ignorant when I did that.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, intersectionality is the currency in human resources department, in corporations. It's the currency utilized in the academy, and it's utilized by, you know, government, you know, institutions, especially those that hire people to work for them. So one could argue, like, has she been co-opted herself. Like, and everything that she discusses hasn't been co-opted in such a way that there is no potency related to it anymore. I would argue that yes. I mean, but first of all, we would have to go through what she means by intersectionality, because a lot of people think they know what she means by it. I try to tell people, look, this is not a dumb woman, man.
Does she sound dumb to y'all? Nah, the thing is, it seemed like she identified an inevitable break in that stance. And I guess that would be the more humanitarian objective stance, you know what I'm saying? Culturally connected one. But she, I guess chose to alter up her black ethos for more, convenient American one, because it seemed like it was inevitability that with whatever loss of cultural insertion black people were doing within their own plights, their own rights, it means something, but it stopped meaning something to us. And I guess once you put it in their academics, maybe they were able to water it down. You know, as how George Carlin says, people do with words. You know what I'm saying? It's not shell shock no more. Post-traumatic stress syndrome. Oh, wait a minute. You know what I mean? Right. It's not anti-blackness. It's not hatred of black people. Now it's dispersion of or minorities or something like that. You know, so those weak euphemisms instead of the strong culture ethos that it had and that it was powered by.
Yeah, I just think, first of all, I think the critical legal scholars to some degree are right. I mean, at the end of the day, I think they are right in a theoretical way. So I think Crenshaw is doing two things with this paper. For one, she's trying to avoid the charge from like people like Thomas Sowell, like who one could argue is the leader of the black conservatives. I mean, of course, there's like John McWhorter. I think that's his name. You got Claude and Shelby Steele. I think Glenn Lurie, also represents a black conservative viewpoint or position. And, her idea is that, okay, you might have basically changed the terms, but like the sentiment of racial ideology is still there. So now you've moved it away from, black people being innately physically inferior, right? Or spiritually inferior related to their race, to now they're culturally inferior. I mean, all you did was switch the term, but you really didn't change anything. All you've done is you've made an apology for continuing the same kind of practices that lead to the material deprivation of a large number of black folks, right? And conjoined to that, she argues, is a concept of the market, which, like in America, black people look at the market. I mean, conservative people, conservatives are neoliberals. I don't know if you know what neoliberalism is, but I mean, to me, it's just like classical liberalism, okay? If right. You understand, like laissez-faire economics. Government is corrupt. People should stay out of the business of the market because when you do, you create inefficiency, non-productivity, and you tamper and you interfere with a process that's already is optimal in and of itself. Now, I think that anything that humans do, whether it be a corporation, I just don't think that there's any kind of social arrangement that is going to be free from human corruption, whether it's in the form of a non-governmental organization, a governmental organization, or a private corporation. This whole idea that government is the innate evil, to me, is connected to, this distrust of the government from the era in which in European culture there was a divine king, or right. Like there was some sort of ecclesiastical abuse that occurred with the Roman Catholic Church, by the selling of indulgences and awarding people, the ability to annul marriages and shit like this.
Right.
I'm not here to say one way or the other that, put it this way. At the end of the day, I just think that across the board, human manipulation and corruption is possible in all areas and domains of social life. So, like, to say that the government is the unique place where corruption can take place, apart from corporations where it doesn't, and everything's just efficient and people are operating on their best behavior there. I just, that's absolute fucking bullshit to me, okay? And so this whole idea that we got to keep government out of private matters and vice versa, so I kind of lean in the direction, to me, of the critical legal scholars, because I think there's a whole bunch of ideology there that basically assumes that the way that the system is set up and established right now is the best that it can possibly be, that nothing else works other than what you see, you know, in terms of like the ideals of the philosophers from modernity. And this is the another issue I have with people who, you know, like purport to be neoliberals or they're conservatives or whatever, and they talk about free market capitalism and, you know, they extol its virtues. I'm like, bro, modern philosophers were the ones who they laid out the foundations of economic theory. They were fucking philosophers, bro. And they weren't engaged in a scientific project like chemistry or biology or physics. So stop trying to equate economics. I mean, there's the veneer of science because there's math involved in it and people make predictions. But come on, man. Like, I mean, psychology is not like fucking chemistry, bro. People try to make predictions about human behavior and psychology. And not to say that there's no, you know, progress that's there at all. But I mean, like, it's not the same kind of, you don't have the same kind of predictive power when it comes to human beings and how they're going to behave and how they ought to behave and how they should behave as with inanimate objects or chemical compounds. You just don't get the same level of consistency.
Perhaps there is a caveat when you're thinking about the environment that the humans are within, because if anything, the environment of the United States has proven the pliability of, you know what I'm saying, the fabric of a human's humanity. Look at what this society, not saying it was the perfect society or even, you know what I'm saying, moral, even balance or nothing like that, but the copacetic-ness that was there, you know what I'm saying, where you had some semblance of a balance, some semblance of familial structure, even though let's say that it was dysfunctional. Well, at least it was a dysfunctional family. Now the family ain't even there no more. A woman ain't a woman, a man ain't a man.
So there's many reasons, but I'm gonna let Faulkner speak, because he, you know, he did graciously and, you know, kind of patiently waited as we continue to hold this like solipsistic conversation. But look, at the end of the day, I think my viewpoint on it is that Southern Democrats, who are now members of the Republican Party, the conservative neoliberal crowd, right? That guy introduced sex into the Civil Rights Act for a reason. And he did it to try to thwart and stymie the progress of race. So instead, what you have is civil rights related to sex, which takes away from the progress related to race. And they knew that would be either the act wouldn't pass because sex was introduced in it, or in the event that sex actually was introduced to it, it would obviate, you know, I won't say obviate, but it would kind of supersede the push for race justice. And that's exactly what has happened. So, and now you got a whole constellation of issues that people are worried about, but nobody ever worries about getting to the ugly part, which is dealing with the injustices related to race. Charles Faulkner, what's cracking with you, dog? What's cracking? Charles, are you there, man?
Woo!
Woo! What's going on with you, dog?
Not much. I'm getting a slight workout in before work later.
I feel you.
I've always wondered, even as a younger man, when this people of color shit started brewing, how much that's going to set black people back alone for that statement alone.
Yeah. Hey, look.
Go ahead.
I want you to go.
And to my surprise, it actually did, because think about it. People tiptoe against race and say, well, they're not prejudiced against because you're black. They're prejudiced because you're insert group here, other than black. And when you just said, it just dawned on me about sex. It always makes me laugh when you hear the statements, I can't find a man on my level. Why? Because you shanghaied and hijacked all the jobs men were supposed to get.
Well, I mean, I've been arguing that. Go ahead.
I mean, you got to think about it. There's no vacuum in nature. There has to be something which you take from to create. There is no metamorphosis without some type of base structure to begin with. So obviously, these careers, these jobs, all this education, it had to be taken from somebody.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, all of it was taken from blacks, man. Like, I mean, in general. Okay. So what happens is that you get Becky and Miss Ann now basically thrown into the pot. I mean, like, not to say that women more didn't need anything, but I think that, like, the way that you do this is, like, imagine you're going to the hospital for an emergency, right? And
mm-hmm.
you basically were in a drive-by shooting, right? But then it turned into a car crash because these things tend to, you know, happen in clusters, right? The shooting and, you know, the crash. So imagine you going to the hospital and then you got a bullet wound in some vital areas of your body, but then you got a broken leg also, okay? Now, as a person who's charged with the responsibility of issuing care in a triage unit, what's the first thing you focus on? You focus on what is the most harmful form of, you know, bodily threat as you can, which
you're gonna
is
look for anything that deals with the breathing, anything that deals with either the breathing or the bloodway.
So you got a bullet hole in the spleen or something like that, and it's bleeding out. You fix that before you fix the broken leg, if the broken leg isn't creating more damage, right? You create the threat, and my viewpoint on it is that the greatest threat to the social body is racism and not sexism. It always has been racism and not sexism, okay?
Yes, it has.
And everybody knows this. This is why even, you know, like, what's the white woman's name she talked about?
Jane Elliott.
No, not Jane Elliott. No, not that lady, man. Phyllis Schlafly. She's like everybody knows that women have been not treated like blacks. You remember I put that short out there a long time ago?
Yeah.
Everybody knows that women have not been treated like blacks. Okay? Anybody that argues otherwise is fucking lying. Come on, man. Let's stop playing games, man. We know.
So with this one scholar being able to sell herself the dream after breaking it apart,
but I mean,
what does that say to, you know, saying the power of that view? I mean, is it largely just money, or like you said, she now has her thumbprint upon how, you know, since society operates in that regard?
Bro, I can't really speak to her internal motivations. Like, All I can do is just look at what she wrote about, unless I could have a conversation with her and talk to her directly, or maybe I could look at some of the speeches that she gives to try to, you know, understand why she took the path that she took. But one could argue more than likely what she ended up doing is, I was talking to BGS earlier today on the phone, man, and ultimately I told him if Kimberly Crenshaw hadn't done it, somebody else was going to do it. Because, you know, the times dictate certain kinds of outcomes, okay? And my belief is that this is where it was going anyway. I mean, you know, with the passage of the Civil Rights Act and sex, you know, being thrust into the equation, it just opened up the pathway quite naturally for people to have a conversation about not only race, but race and sex. White women are talking about sex. Black people are talking about race, right? And then black women were like, well, okay, well, when people talk about race, they're talking primarily about black men. But when they talk about sex, they're primarily talking about white women. What about us and the unique challenges we face? Right. And as an attorney and somebody who's bright as she is, she's like, well, what about us? Which, I don't have an issue. Like, I mean, principally, I don't have an issue with that.
Right.
However, I think when you pay attention to yourself and then you start to say things that like are matters of fact statements, but you don't back those statements up with any empirical data to either falsify or to confirm it, that's when I think that the problems ensue. Okay, so, and I'll talk about that as I, you know, get further into like her whole spiel about what intersectionality is and about like black privilege in terms of black male privilege, because she does talk about that, right?
Right. It's largely a stratification of blackness, though, because with you know, if it was part largely the black man who, when as far as it goes with racism, was being tested as the highest victim, well, they was connecting that our family to us, right? So it's like she saw a niche and basically a loophole in it. And like, okay, it's valid, but the blackness that the system was interacting with was the entirety of us. It didn't break us up. It just put us as the symbol of the black family, you know, the black group. But yeah, I guess she saw.
Wait a minute. They said we actually have privilege. Yeah.
But you gotta look. This is one thing. Look, this is one thing you gotta understand. This woman is like, I can tell you, I can affirm this. If you are a professor at an Ivy League institution, some of the things you teach are going to, you know, some of the things you teach are going to be able to be chosen by you, because there is academic autonomy to a certain extent. Right. But then also there's the canon. Also, you know, there's a whole host of scholarship that if you're a professional, you have to know. And you have to be competent to have conversations with people who are experts in it. Like, if say, for example, I think at Cornell University, I think is where she was a professor. I can't remember. But all I can tell you is this. You have to, if she's a professor, she has to be able to talk about the prevailing, and she teaches anti-discrimination law. She has to know about all forms of discrimination as it pertains to the law. Mm. Okay, so like there's no, to me, that's why I say that this was an inevitable consequence of anti-discrimination law itself. Okay, so, and here's the deal. Like, if she talks about racial discrimination, then she has to also talk about sexual discrimination, because it's part of the law now. Mm-hmm. She has to talk about it, right? But then in order for her to be able to talk about it competently, she has to be able to refer to the people who are talking about it and who have like the loudest voices at conferences, the people who are publishing about it in the time frame, you know, that she's writing herself. You know, like, she has to thrust herself into the conversation. Okay?
I'm still tripping about that black male privilege.
Well, like, I mean, you don't hear, she won't begin to discuss the various ways in which black men have privilege. Because in this paper, there's there's some reference. I see hints of it, but it's not strong in this paper. But like, she doesn't talk about black male privilege in this paper. She's talking about black people collectively. She's talking about race collectively in this paper. Okay? Now, she hints that there might be tensions between various identity groups, and she cautions against it.
Right.
In this paper. She's like, let's not be co-opted and fragmented. You know, the conditions have been set up and established when you remove formal barriers to discrimination, right? Because blacks are different, they have different levels of education, different class backgrounds, and so on. This is going to create, because there's no ostensible form of oppression, it's going to create fragmentation. So then the question is, how can we maintain strategically a collective consciousness so that we can be, you know, continue this fight? Right? But then she also understands that the tools by which to fight in and of itself, buried within them, is, you know, like this whole trajectory towards which discrimination still can come out, because you're using, it's like trying to use the master's tools, but this motherfucker put a spell on it to where if you kill somebody, it takes 10% of your health.
Right.
Like a video game type shit. I mean, you know, if I can use an analogy, right? So the more you use it and you think you're destroying or raising the enemy, you're building up part of their forces. You're establishing another fort or another bulwark from which they could fire bullets.
So in other words, we're basically creating a Hydra.
Basically, I mean,
yep.
But I mean, she said, but her idea though is that, look, there's no other choice. What else could black people have done other than to use the rights rhetoric that they utilized in order to try to fight back against, you know, violence and racial intimidation? And, you know, like, you know, like also, like, what else was there to do other than to, you know, expose the horrid conditions, you know, like that existed within Jim Crow America? Like, what else were we to do? You know, I mean, I think that's one of the things that she tries to point out. Like, what other option did we have? Like, this whole idea of trash and rice rhetoric and creating an entirely different, you know, culture from scratch. Like, how could blacks even possibly do some shit like that? She's like, that's impractical. And I think she's right about that, though. I think she's right about that. Shout out to Ryan Hart. He said, needed discussion. Appreciate that donation, my brother. Appreciate that. I know this is not titillating, man. Look, I get it. This is not exciting. I ain't talking about these hoes and all this kind of shit today. And, you know, that really doesn't, you know.
Remember, GG, hoes can wait.
Hey, man.
All right. And hoes going to be there.
If we always. Because I've read the shit, maybe you don't have to read it. Maybe you can listen to it. And maybe you can listen to my explanation of it so that you can more fully understand what our actual position is, as opposed to some of these knuckleheads out here who, you know, they take on this woke, you know, they put on this mask, this woke mask, but they never even read Crenshaw. I guarantee you, like, most of these people have never even been over race, reform, and retrenchment, transformation, and anti-discrimination. I guarantee you they haven't read it. At least if you watch the show, tangentially, you could at least say, well, I'm exposed to some of the concepts therein. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, and then the next paper I'm going to read, if black women direct their ire towards corporate America, I don't have a problem with that.
Right.
If black women say, okay, well, you know, we're being treated unfairly and unjustly by corporate structures, I, for the most part, don't have an issue with that. But don't do so by throwing us under the bus. And when she gets to the second paper I'm gonna read is, you know, like her talking about corporate structure. And, you know, it is a paper about intersectionality, but that's the first time that she really begins to use the phrase. Okay? That's the first time she starts to use it. And damn, but them motherfuckers, man, all these memberships are renewing right now. all that gorilla shit.
Yeah.
But I mean, all she's doing is directing at that phase, the second paper, she's directing at the ways in which corporations are like not acknowledging black women's humanity and not treating them fairly in terms of the kind of wages they make and the advancement they can make within the context of being, you know, an employee. Right? And I talked about it briefly, but I didn't go through the paper. I think it's important to go through the paper, okay, and to see what she actually says and the grounds that she uses in order to say it. Because the woman is not dumb. Right? Like, you can say whatever you want to say about her arguments, but one thing you're not going to say is she's dumb and inarticulate. You can't say that. Does she sound dumb and inarticulate to you as I read what she wrote?
Not at all. Very thorough.
the whole point is, if she were to have a conversation with us in this space, like, would motherfuckers even had a capacity to argue with her?
Very few would, because the thing is, you would have to, one, respect her stance where she's at, and to the point to where you permit her to take you on the journey to see how she arrived there. Because if she broke it down prior to arriving with the other party, it's like, what shifted then? What shifted in your value? What shifted in how your measure process went for your first thesis? I was, you know what I mean? It's, if anything, I wouldn't, because a lot of people probably approach it as an attack, as opposed to how could someone like you be convinced to go that route?
Well, I say, again, as I said, I can only speculate about this unless I can speak with her directly.
Yeah.
And then, you know, ask her, when did you get the notion that it was time to now, like, abandon the project of talking about race as a whole, but to focus, you know, like in a kind of hyperbolic way, I guess, you know, this intersectional way, like, mm-hmm. And then also you got to think, anytime, this, I guess it sounds racist, but anytime you got pilgrims, that's your language, right?
Yeah.
Anytime pilgrims like begin to use some shit and like, yeah, I think that's really great. It works in service of some function that they're trying to perform,
right?
Which is co-optive, like, which is what she says she wants to avoid. Like, come on, lady, you know you've been co-opted. You gotta know.
When you look around, you might have.
Huh?
Well, goddamn pilgrim, you know you took that away from me, pilgrim. Goddamn, black man still has every goddamn thing. Can't even breathe the white man's precious air. Goddamn, pilgrim.
Down up on the Swami River.
Every but time see, he second, says it.
But look, the second paper she writes, so she wrote the first paper in 1988. Now, I don't know if it was the first paper she ever wrote. Okay, I can't say. Okay, she might have wrote some prior to that. I have to look at her curriculum vitae to see. Right. But, I mean, when you look up the papers that she wrote, these are the ones that pop up, okay? And the first paper where she talks about intersectionality is Demarginalizing the Intersection of Race and Sex, a Black Feminist Critique of Anti-Discrimination Doctrine, Feminist Theory, and Anti-Racist Politics. Now, to me, it's like, okay, well, in 1988, you wrote a paper, Race, Reform and Retrenchment, which has nothing to do with feminism. But the second paper you write, you go full tilt feminist. Like, how does that happen within the context of 1 year? I don't think it does. Now, either one, she's like, okay, well, let me submerge conversations about feminism because it's not really actually popular, or I don't know. I would have to speak to her. But like, why is it now that you went full tilt into this?
But the thing is, you know what feminism does to them, right? It makes them focus on them, and this is something that they should do, but they don't understand that they're doing it from a pilgrim's perspective. There's nothing wrong with you becoming the sole focus of your analysis and instilling worth and everything, but the fact that you have to have a juxtaposed, you know what I'm saying, objectified person there, and it just so happens to be the one that you're going through the cause of all your traumas with. That's the ill part, because they've never really looked into themselves. Now, with I think for the women who went the route of Pan-Africanism, possibly there was some elements of that in there, but those who didn't, it wasn't within the Black community. And if they were going to be within academia, you know, Pilgrimville, Pleasantville, it is what it is. You're going to be around them, they're going to absorb, they're going to start vibing. And they were instilling a high ethos of woman value within them. Maybe that's what they wasn't getting at from the civil rights at the level which they, you know, that they needed.
Yeah, see, I don't know, like, does she have a husband?
No. I'm looking up.
Yeah, like, I haven't paid attention. I know she was born and raised in Canton, Ohio. Okay. She keeps the marital status private. Don't know if she's married, single, divorced, none of that shit. Don't know. But you ain't never seen, if you ain't never seen her with a man, and she don't love that motherfucker too much.
Nah.
Right? Nah. At least a motherfucker, like, man, bro, at least motherfucker, like, you know who Oprah was fucking back in the day. Right?
Yeah.
She's fucking Stedman, right?
Stedman, yeah.
I ain't nobody ever seen Kimberly with a nigga. Or a white boy. I know for a fact,
If I'm smashing you, bitch, you're going to take me somewhere. I'm going to eat one of the motherfucking symposiums. I'm going to be eating cheese and crackers and drinking some wine with some white motherfuckers. Real talk.
Yeah.
That's just me. You know what I'm saying? Like, if I'm smashing you, I ain't saying that I got to be everywhere you are. But you ain't going to, like, put me in the closet like I'm some motherfucking embarrassment. No, fuck all that. I ain't. Look, I'll kick Rob, be fucking somebody else. You feel me?
Already.
Fuck all that, man. I ain't got time for that. But anyway, shout out to, I don't know how to pronounce that.
Jinkazi.
What's happened with Crenshaw is largely interest convergence with white women. I think that's some shit there. White women tolerate racism talk, but they'll pay to talk about sexism. Steinem and Michelle Wallace, 80s or today, with Rebecca Traister and Brittany Cooper. I think that's accurate, you know, to a certain extent. I think that it's funny, man. Look, I remember being a postdoctor at a university, and there was a course called the philosophy of race that had to be taught. And a white woman was going up, I guess, you know, for tenure. And I guess she figured that she wanted to have that on her vitae when she went up for tenure. And, but in my mind, I'm thinking, motherfucker, lady, you're going to make tenure. Like, why do you even need this shit? Or I need it more than you need it. You got a tenure track position. I'm a postdoc. And then I'm a black motherfucker. So why would you force yourself? I mean, she got rank over me because she's a tenure professor and, you know, not a tenure, but she's an associate, an assistant professor who's seeking to become an associate. And she's part of the tenure track faculty, though. So I'm just a postdoc. My job is going to terminate at some point, right? I got an end date. But I'm looking for a job. But, like, you got one. It'll do me a benefit more so than you. And you got to think. You're a white lady. Why the fuck are you insisting on teaching fucking the philosophy of race anyway? That would be like me insisting that I teach feminism. If like, say, for example, I was a male professor at the university and I had, you know, I'm competent to teach feminism, but then there's a girl with a postdoc and, you know, like wouldn't I look like an asshole insisting that I teach it and not her?
Definitely.
Well, you need to teach ethics and intro. I'm going to take on the task of teaching this upper level course because, you know, fuck it, because I can.
Right.
It's the sort of shit they do. She is a founder. She coined the phrase critical race theory. So one could argue that she is like one of the people who founded it. Okay. But then the question is, like, why does she drop these conversations about race in the way that she did? And she picked up the mantle of having these conversations in such a way that I think is. Look, Adolph Reese, I put a clip of this shit. BGS did a video talking about me talking about it. But the whole point is, Adolph Reed says, intersectionality is really a product of the academy. Or you know, or the professoriate in any rate. Because now you get black women who get jobs. And motherfuckers are competing about who's going to teach what and who's justified in being in what position they're in. And can you get more of the motherfuckers that look like you in there teaching the shit that you're teaching? So it's all about faculty lines and shit like this. So if you're a woman and you're black, quite naturally, you're going to be like, well, shit, anti-discrimination, shit. I'm discriminated because I'm a woman and I'm black. It's like the double jeopardy
right
kind of phenomenon. Why not promote your need to be there?
I mean, and if you have all these burgeoning factors that are expanding upon the political scape, you know what I'm saying? Everything came from the Black Studies push, and then they figured, okay, well, yo, this is pretty potent. We can cut this into myriad of ways with different people and still avoid direct engagement of particularly black community, but also deal with these other folks who are eventually going to have valid issues down the line. And I think that this gives ruling elite, if you will, a lot more power of operating it. So it's still a zero sum game, but I think what, like you ask, you eventually want to sit before the person and get in their mind, like, what is it that make you go this route when before you were the one who was delivering thorough analysis, you know what I'm saying, of the antithesis of where, you know, what your direction is now. And if it's only money, all right, let it be known, you know what I'm saying, it is what it is. Don't have to play the game, but you know what I'm saying? if you're the blueprint maker.
I ain't hating
up
for getting no money, you know what I'm saying? Like, right. like this guy here says, Jinkazi says, or Jinkazi E, she gets too much credit for CTR. She was an understudy of Derek Bell. Like, okay, Derek, it ain't no question. A person who's a professor at a university is a white collar worker. And in all likelihood, they're, you know, like high earners. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, you know, like if you're a tenured professor, you're typically going to be making six figures. You know what I mean? Especially if you're teaching in the summertime and then, you know, you got other types of shit that you're able to do. Because it's not, well, it all depends on like what your ambitions are as a professor. But the workload is not like, say, for example, like that of a construction worker, bro. You have, when you go home, you're not beat the fuck down. Okay, it's not like a police officer, like when you get off, you got to go drink all fucking day and night because you're worried about like whether you're going to get shot or not the next day. And you're beating up people here and there. You know what I'm saying? Like it does something to your psyche. This shit, like you fucking teaching, you're having, it's the shit I'm doing on the internet that they doing in the classroom.
Not at all.
This is not like, you know, like it's not a stressful life. It can be stressful because, you know, human beings in general, like, especially at that level, they can be petty as fuck. You ever heard two smart motherfuckers argue for an hour over some stupid shit?
You're yeah, likely they're very to catty. Encounter it. Huh? You're they're likely very to encounter shit. It.
Man, but just imagine that you got, like, people on a committee, and they're arguing with each other over who they're going to hire. Well, I like this person for that reason. I like that person for this reason. I don't like that person for this reason. Like, man, bruh. I'm trying to go get, man, I got a hot date, motherfucker, and y'all lengthening this meeting. Now I got to tell this motherfucking chick I'm about to smash. I got to get 20, I'm going to be 20, 30 minutes late because y'all motherfuckers arguing over some petty shit. And ain't going to be no resolution today, so we may as well table the discussion for a later time. But motherfuckers in the academy can turn something that's supposed to take 20 minutes into 2 hours.
That's the double-edged sword of
too smart for their own good.
Sharp intelligence. I mean, well, I mean, if anyone has engaged in higher education and you've gone to, you know, places where family is and they have not, you know, speaking over people's head, just, you know, speaking on the day to day. So it's like, damn, right? You know, it can't occur. And that was actually one of the things that academia pointed out back in the past. You know what I'm saying, for black people who had so-called grown too intelligent to actually be of adequate assistance for the place that they left, you know.
Does this motherfucker got Obi-Wan and the Grovey back? What type of shit this nigga, man?
That's why you got to hold on to
the car. This nigga got, hold on, man. This nigga got Obi-Wan and the Grovey.
Yes.
Boy, you a motherfucking fool, man.
Yeah, it's master of the nigga force. Yes, you know. The force is strong with this motherfucker.
Boy, you something else, man. I'm like, what the fuck? Obi-Wan, I thought you was going to see Obi-Wan Kenobi. This is a Negrovi, man. Dude, you crazy. But, I mean, look. I think ultimately, she's worried about black people being fragmented and split into pieces, and then she goes up and makes a theory that splits black people into more fucking pieces. I'm exactly. Like, why? What the fuck, man? Like,
aren't we split and fragmented already? I mean, when the LGBT community start to really kick off with their political agendas, you saw more people identifying as being gay, lesbian, or whatever, more than they did black.
Facts.
So,
but you know why that is, though. I mean, I'm pretty sure you kind of, you understand why that is to some degree. I mean, like, first and foremost, let me just say this. Nobody wants to be a nigga.
No, nobody okay. wants. Not even a nigga.
Okay, at the end of the, I think there's a paper, I have to look at it. I've seen it before, but I gotta find it. But there's like a scale, a masculinity scale associated with being black. Mm-hmm. And being male or female and being straight or gay, but primarily it's about just racial and sex-based categories. So, like, on the femininity scale, women, white women are going to be like ranked very high on the femininity scale. Black women are going to be ranked high on the masculinity scale in relation to white women. Okay. But black men are going to be perceived as hyper masculine to cover up for the inadequacies associated with them not being in control. So they're going to be more violent and, you know, pathological than, say, for example, white dudes. Or maybe white guys. I have to look at it. Maybe I'm misquoting. But the whole point is,
he's not just strong, he's nigga strong.
But the point is, look, and I might be wrong about that. I have to look at the paper again. But, I mean, at the end of the day, suffice it to say, you don't want to, the further away from black masculinity you can get is what you'll do. And if that means being gay, like, that's why that fucking, like, that skit from Dave Chappelle where he talked about niggas starting to wear high heels, fuck it, you know, like, niggas getting shot, like, how do you prevent it from happening? You just, you fucking act like a woman.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got to see, growing up, looking at all the benefits women in your community have received, and then you're not growing up without fathers or male figures, authority figures, you're going to see femininity as power.
Right.
Well, that's why everything's getting bitch made now. You know what I'm saying? Bitch made dances, bitch made clothes, the lyrics is bitch made, the delivery
anytime
of the lyrics
you wearing
is bitch
a dress,
made.
Anytime you trying to make, you trying to act all thugged out wearing a dress, you're lost.
Yeah, I think Jim Casey, he's in the know though. So I guess he has some background in academy, you know, in the academy to some degree, or he's read like Curry or something like that. Like at the end of the day, you know, like what Curry is gonna say is that, because there is a certain set of canon as it pertains to feminist thought. Okay, so like you're gonna have to read Catherine McKinnon Towards the Feminist Theory of the State. You're going to read Andrea Dworkin. You're going to read Ellen Pence. You're going to read Shula Smith Firestone. You're going to read, you know, you're going to read Dominus Feminist, okay, and what they have to say about violence and sexual assault and the objectification of female bodies and shit like that. You're going to be exposed to that. Now, the question is, like, I mean, because she's writing in anti-discrimination, she would be vulnerable to that kind, those kind of ideals being interpolated into her own writing. Because she's gonna be teaching the shit. So why not write about what you're teaching? You know what I'm saying? Now, I'm just being charitable in terms of like how, or trying to give an explanation. I'm not engaging in any normativity at all related to this. I'm just trying to explain how it might have come to pass. But again, I'm only speculating. You know what I'm saying? So look, he says it's GG's fault. If you had a stable of fours and fives at the university, we wouldn't be getting these reports. They want PhD brothers to want them. They will share. Man, look, bro. Nobody wants, you know, like, put it this way, man. You know, like, a lot of black women in the university, you know what I'm saying? Some of them fuck with niggas. I've had women hit on me at the university and shit like that. Like, if I did some of the shit that they have done, I probably would have got a violation. you feel me? I had a chick call me from a university, man, like, because she got my name from a fucking listserv, you know, that all faculty members get from others. You know what I'm saying? With the emails, their home, you know, their cell phones, the office phones and all this kind of shit. This chick called me. I'm at the crib chilling. Call me out the blue, like, hey. I'm like, what's cracking? How you doing, Dr. Blah, blah, blah? Oh, I'm nothing, doctor. Okay, well, what's going on? What's happening? Oh, I just kind of wanted to talk to you about some bullshit. Now we talking about sex and shit like this. Like, who wants to fuck with who and who don't? And who's got their eye on who and who don't? And what you look like and if you're attractive or not and all this kind of shit. I'm like, how the fuck did that come to pass? Because if I guarantee you, if I would, just imagine me cold calling some random ass professor because she got a fat ass. And what would have been the blowback of that if she objected to it? But it ain't nothing that they got to think about. Because 9 times out of 10, a nigga feel like he the king of the earth if one of these hoes try to give him some play. Am I wrong or right? Oh, the niggas will brag about it. Oh, she on my dick. He's something to brag and go tell his boys about. You don't perceive it as, this, you know, like some sort of fucking assault. Or, you know, a woman crossing the boundaries. Because you haven't been enculturated or indoctrinated to think that way. But I know one thing, you know, I was like, because I really didn't want to. She had a friend who do, you know, like a woman who worked at the university who did have a big old fat ass, right? And if I had to fuck with one of them, it would have been the one with the big old fat ass and not the one who called. But she ended up telling me that the girl with the big old, the woman with the big old fat ass did want to holler at. So I was like, well, thank you for that info. I'll keep that in my, you know, my info Rolodex. So then one day I might be able to smash that. Thank you. Appreciate that. Yeah, I'm just keeping it a buck. But you gotta be careful, man. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, and then you fucking with these women that you work with, man. One of the things you gotta be careful of, man, all this fucking the chicks where you work at, bro. Don't do that, man. You gotta keep it motherfucking Keanu Reeves nowadays. Motherfucker, take a photo. You've got your fingers like in the peace pose. You got them around them, but yep. You ain't touching them.
Exactly. I don't want to get me too. Yeah, I'm finna mash out, Gigi. Thanks for the sharpening and thanks for the hospitality. Respect, y'all.
For sure, for sure. Peace out, my bro, my boy. And look, he said I'm talking about the ugly ones like Crenshaw. They ain't gonna snitch. Shit, them motherfuckers will snitch too. In fact, I said this before. Let me find this paper, man. I ain't gonna read it, but eventually I will end up reading it. Let me show you this shit, bro. It ain't gonna be the next one I'm gonna read, but it is gonna be one I'm gonna read. Can you see that?
Yes, sir.
Mapping the margins of intersectionality, identity politics, and violence against women of color.
Wow.
Now this is the first time she puts a tracer on black men. Like in a direct way.
You know, okay. Gigi, it's kind of funny you mentioned that because I had to tell somebody to look up the statistics on domestic violence in the black community. And they were swearing up and down that black men are so violent, we're, you know, offing women at an alarming rate. So she came back to me and said, you're right, we're more violent. Yeah, because you don't know anything about, you know, you don't believe that the law is, you know, in accordance with you. You believe that you shouldn't follow it.
Well, look, here's the point. Why would you worry about punishment if, on average, you don't get punished?
Exactly. There's no repercussions, no consequences.
I mean, think about it. So in this paper, she basically says, look, and I ain't going to read it, but I do want, you know, she says, look, I wish I can get rid of this damn, hold on, let me see, view, read mode. I don't like the way that looks. Still there. Maybe I can't get rid of it. Motherfucker. All right, I ain't going to worry about it. Okay, that's how I get rid of it. Okay. Over the last two decades, women have organized against the almost routine violence that shapes their lives. So, over the last two decades, women have organized against the routine violence that they're exposed to.
Routine.
Drawing from the strength of shared experience, like the stories that they tell each other, like we drawing from the strength of conversations that we have with one another, our shared experiences about what we've gone through, women have come to know, have recognized the political demands of millions speak more powerfully than the pleas of a few isolated voices. This politicization has in turn has transformed the way we understand violence against women. Now, the first thing I want to say is this. women act as if violence is something that they are exposed to more than men. I mean, that's the assumption I get, that there's some sort of special kind of violence that women endure that, like, men don't.
I mean, you know, it's nothing much. You know, men fought all your wars throughout history and prehistory. Men have done the more dangerous jobs. You know, just being human is to be violent.
But here's the important kicker to this, though. And I pointed this out elsewhere. That's not the one. But this paper was written in 1991, published in the Stanford Law Review. Okay? 1991. Now, if you're going to make a claim, and maybe this is just oversight, and it's predicated upon her, you know, methodology, which more than likely is going to be qualitative more so than quantitative. It's going to be probably more social or humanities-based, dealing with arguments than it is dealing with facts and dealing with, you know, like straight-up social science, okay?
No.
But the thing is, you write this paper and you discuss the various ways in which over the last two decades women have been organizing against the almost routine violence that shapes their lives. But I mean, there's but implicit within this is the idea that, like, you know, like women are suffering from unique forms of violence that nobody else is, and that not only that, that women aren't actually engaged in that same form of violence that they say that they're routinely exposed to, that they're also not doing it. And the funny thing is, and this is why this is published by the Bureau of Justice Statistics, okay? Now, the year exactly, let me X that out. When was this published exactly? 1998, okay? So almost 26 years ago, or 25 years ago, this shit was published. But there was already DOJ information out there that between 1976 and 1989, more black men were killed by their wives than black women were killed by their husbands. Now, as a scholar, if you're writing about the facts about violence in the black community and you're really dedicated to figuring out what the truth is, you have access to information that, if you're not ideologically jaded yourself, you would know that there's something different between the interaction or the interrelationship between black men and women than what white dominance feminists have to say about it. That there's something else going on there that can't be explained, you know, purely by dominance feminism.
Well, like, you got to think about it.
What Ella Pence has to say is not going to be right. What Catherine McKinnon has to say about it is not going to be right. What Andrea Dworkin has to say about it is not going to be accurate, especially if you got more black men being killed by their wives than black women being killed by their husbands. Obviously, there's something fucking different going on in the black community, and that you're also perpetrators of the very fucking crimes that you're saying you want to be protected against.
Well, it's kind of like throwing a rock and then hiding your hand.
I think so.
And what happens is that, especially in the black community, well, it could be any community, but we're dealing specifically with black. We'd rather believe the sensational lie over the simplistic truth any day of the week. You'd be surprised how many times I'll get called to a scene and somebody will tell me, that's not how the law works. Nigga, you called me. And it's crazy. Even as a sergeant, you know, running a midnight shift, I'll look at some of my subordinates and be like, how old are you? Well, I'm 20. You do know I've been an officer longer than you've been an adult. You were like in kindergarten when I started. Stop. And it's the reason why is because you have situations like this where they can justify why I'm not in a relationship because all black men are evil. These black men don't deserve mercy. They need to be locked up. It's always some racial rhetoric when you listen to this. And it's crazy because you said 91. That's like, what, 32 years? 32 years, and you've seen what black men have went through. And like you said, you bring up the stats. Notice nobody wants to bring up any evidence.
But see, here's the thing, right? I'm not saying that women don't get exposed to sexual assault. They do. And that men do it. They do.
Yeah.
But the inverse is also true. But it's never discussed or talked about. And that's the issue I have. So, like, when someone says the only special violence I can give them is rape, well, you can't just give them that either.
Well, you cannot give them that because, one, when you talk about sexual assault to women, we got to stop the show, stop, you know, stop the presses. We need a manhunt. But how many men are sexually assaulted in jail, in schools, and even by their babysitters? Do you know how many young men I've coached in wrestling whose first sexual act was with their babysitter, and they didn't even know, they didn't even have a concept of what they were doing?
Look, this is put out by Dr. Tiasan Johnson, okay? The information on male rape is recent, fairly, because rape has always been defined as something only women experience. Now that definition of rape encapsulates males. The definition of rape encapsulates males. The findings have severely challenged the prevailing feminist notion that rape is a product of rape culture that only focuses on females, but rather highlights that men and women merely have different methods for sexually violating each other and themselves. So, I mean, you know, so 2.7. So the first thing he says is 2.78 million men in the U.S. have been victims of sexual assault or rape. Okay, from 1930 to 2012, the FBI defined forcible rape for data collecting purposes as, quote, the carnal knowledge of a female forcibly and against her will, unquote.
Mm-hmm. To give you an example, when I first went to the department, you either had sexual assault and rape. It was the same charge, but it was classified because of the vagina.
Right. So eventually, localities began to rebel against that limited gender-bound definition. In 2010, Chicago reported 86,767 cases of rape, but used its own broader definition, so the FBI left out the Chicago stats. Finally, in 2012, the FBI revised its definition of focused on penetration with no mention of female or force. So although this is helpful, it ignores made to penetrate situations for males. But anyway, a recent analysis of BJS, which is the Bureau of Justice Statistics, turned up that 46% of male victims reported a female perpetrator. So it's not just sexual assault. It's not just something men are doing to other men. Women are engaging in it as well. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
One out of every four black men and black women have experienced rape, physical violence, and stalking by an intimate partner in a lifetime. In a survey by Stemple and Meyer, women were more likely to be abused by fellow female inmates and men by guards, and many of those guards were female. Okay. For example, of juveniles reporting staff sexual misconduct, 89% were boys reporting abuse by a female staff member. In total, inmates reported an astronomical 900,000 incidents of sexual abuse. The CDC, which is the Centers for Disease Control, invented a category of sexual violence called being made to penetrate. The definition includes victims, male and female, who were forced to penetrate someone else with their own body parts or a foreign item, either by physical force or coercion, or when the victim was drunk or high, or otherwise unable to consent. When those cases were taken into account, the rates of non-consensual sexual contact basically equalized, with 1.270 million women and 1.267 million men claiming to be the victims of sexual violence. Okay? CDC finding that women rape men as often as men rape women. The CDC also notes that men account for over a third of those experiencing another form of sexual violence, sexual coercion, that was defined as being pressured into sexual activity by psychological means, lies or false promises, threats to end a relationship or to spread negative gossip, or making repeated requests for sex and expressing unhappiness at being turned down. As criminologists Richard Felsen and Patrick Cundiff report in a fascinating recent analysis, a 15-year-old male is considerably more likely to be sexually assaulted than a woman over 40. The CDC reports that 12.3% of female victims were 10 or younger at the time of their first completed rape victimization. For male victims, that number is 27.8%. So you can't just get, you can't give them that either. Now, the whole point I'm saying, the reason I say this is not to take away from shit that women go through. It's not the point. The point is, you're not the only motherfuckers going through it.
Yeah, that's not singular. And could you do me a favor? I put my email in the back check. Could you email that to me?
Yeah, I'll get it to you. Yeah,
appreciate it.
For sure.
But it makes you think, if as long as you hear rhetoric, because of course, by, you know, being a professor, you have to be a researcher by trade.
Yeah, but not necessarily. I mean, there are different forms of research that are done by different kinds of professors. Like, I can guarantee you the typical way that a law professor goes about researching data is going to be a little bit different than that of, say, for example, a social scientist, somebody in a sociology or a psychology department or a criminology department. However, if you're going to make bold claims and then, you know, bask in the glory of a new definition, you got to actually fucking back that shit up. Now hold on for a second, man. I'm gonna take a break for one quick second. I want you to talk to the people for a second. I forgot, man. I ordered these groceries, man. That shit probably outside right now, it's sitting on the front porch.
I got you, man. So it's kind of funny how you have these highly degreed people come up there with their notions because of their bias and the fact that they know they're going to get certain funding by certain organizations because of stuff like this. I want you to think about this. Even as a law enforcement officer, out of all the sexual assault cases I had in 15 years, only one I had was valid. Not saying that there are no valid cases, but it just lets you know that people use this rhetoric as a weapon, man. They really do. Like, this only happens to women. Protect all women. Nobody talks about the young men who are victims of this on the reverse end. Look at how many college athletes who were ruined from false allegations. Look at how many young boys and girls who were touched by their teachers. And I'm pretty sure that the boys may even have it worse because people are less likely to believe or even research to see what they're doing or see how they're being treated. That was a good strain right there. So I'm just looking at this as Not only as a viewer, but also as an officer, how many, like I just said earlier, you could not have a guy who was in a forced sexual assault. You could not classify that as rape. When I first joined the department, you could not. Now you can, because they changed the, like Gigi read, they changed the formatting. But back then, that's how much emphasis was different. But like they said, look at the difference in numbering on who's more likely to be a victim than who. I'm not trying to say, yeah, you know, the women deserve it or nothing like that. I'm not going by that. I'm just stating a factual thing. Look at how different the same crime can be used in a court of law and see how different that victim, quotation marks, is going to be treated. As a matter of fact, a lot of times you're going to have a lot of males who are treated like it's their fault more than being a victim.
Bro, I had chicken out there, man, motherfucking 2 gallons of milk, motherfucking bacon, And, you know, they got cats in this neighborhood and shit, but I'm glad them cats ain't start digging inside them damn bags. Hey, ground beef out there, almonds, spinach and man. Shit.
Like, oh, man, they would've ate good. They've been like, no damn. Cats would have found them. Would have found a girl and they'd be grilling this shit.
If I'd have been looking at my phone, I would have got the text that told me what was going on. So let me look at my phone right quick. Hold on.
Mm-hmm. Good thing he found it because the cats would have had a feast out that bitch. They'd have been playing so like.
This is what happens when. This is what fucking happens when you ain't looking at your phone, man. You know what I'm saying? This is the sort of shit that happens when you're not paying attention to your phone, bro. But shout out to Swift for hitting me on the Cash App. Appreciate that, sir. Shout out to K-Line for hitting me on the Cash App. Appreciate that, sir. Appreciate that, sir. Shout out to T-Fitness for you for hitting me up on the Cash App. Appreciate that. And, Shout out to my nigga Nubis, man. Shout out my nigga Nubis, bro. shout out my nigga Nubis, man. Shout out my nigga Nubis, man. Shout out my nigga Nubis. But, if I can find this down. Some reason I'm kind of like not able to find the shit that I want to be able to find right now. And it's kind of getting on my nerves. It's like the King Kong. Shout out to my nigga Nubis, man. Shout out to my nigga Nubis, man. And shout out to Milton Patton, man. Appreciate the donation, sir. Appreciate that. Appreciate that, man. That shit goes a long way. And so ultimately, you know, my goal is to help you understand these issues, man. That's all I want you to do is to speak about them, not according to popular opinion, but like if we're going to talk about the work of scholars, let's dig into the bowels and entrails of what they've actually said. Now, principally, there's not a lot that I object to with what Crenshaw said in this article, Race, Reform, and Retrenchment. But I can tell you, I do disagree with a lot of what she has to say in mapping the margins. Now, I don't so much have a lot to say about what she says in, you know, the second article I'm going to read, which is called, Mapping the Margins, Intersectionality, Identity Politics. That's not it. That's not the fucking one. Why? Which one is it? Yeah, it's called, Demarginalizing the Intersections. The Intersection of Race and Sex, a Black Feminist Critique of Anti-Discrimination Doctrine, Feminist Theory, and Anti-Racist Politics. So that's the one that, I'm going to read next. But at the end of the day, I don't really... It ain't that egregious to me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, like, if you think about it, but there are some issues that I have with it, but it's not as fucked up as what she's got to say in the third article. It's just not. Look, Seth Sun says, my hypothesis, Crenshaw determined that we are doomed and went for the bad. Well, I mean, you know, look, a lot of people have... I think she got bombarded with a whole bunch of thought and philosophy and really didn't, you know, like, because she's bright enough to wing it, she really didn't, like, dig into what she was reading with a fine-tooth comb like she should have. And she did a disservice to Black men by, you know, kind of, like, confirming some of the, you know, inherently racist ideas embedded within, you know, the work of Susan Brown Miller, Catherine McKinnon, Andrea Dworkin, and the kind of misandric, you know, work from people like Ellen Pence, who later recanted some of the shit that they said. But, you know, having said all that, man, all I can tell you is, you can't, You can't put the toothpaste back in the tube, man. I mean, but you can correct what's incorrect. And you can get people to say, hey, look, we were wrong about X, Y, and Z. But they're not going to come right out and say it. I mean, especially when people have pet theories and everybody comes to adore them and they utilize them for their own purposes. Like, there is no fucking doubt and shadow of a doubt in my mind that like, white feminists have co-opted intersectionality. They have. The question is, what function does it serve to white supremacy for them to be able to utilize it in the manner in which they do? And I was making a point earlier about how nobody wants to be a nigga. Or nobody wants to be close to black men because you know that that's like, what they call the shit? You hot, dog. You know, on the street. Like, the nigga who just got bagged up in a dope raid, nobody is trying to fuck with that nigga. At least till he get out of fucking prison. And I ain't talking about jail. I'm talking about till this nigga get out of prison because there's a high likelihood that this nigga done, you know, been indicted and is red hot and is going to start snitching on niggas. So he hot. Don't fuck with him. So that's how they treat black men, man. You hot. And you get currency by distancing yourself from black men. You gain safety from distancing yourself from what is considered to be inherently pathological. It just is what it is, fam. I ain't make it that way. It just is the way that it is. I don't like it being that way. But damn, it's the way that it is, man. Do I wish it was different than the way that it is? Man. Yeah, man. I mean, you know. Who wants to constantly be subjected to danger, man, at every turn? And subjected to, you know, insult and injury at every turn. Who wants to fucking deal with that? Who wants to be subjected to wanton and indiscriminate violence at any moment? Who wants that? But it's the reality that you, and the absurdity that you must deal with. It's what you have to. I call it, and I call the shit dumping. It's a new term I came up with. What happens to black men is we get dumped on. We get fucking dumped on. And it's not something that's fun, man, to be dumped on. To have the weight of the world bear down on your shoulders and for it to be understood that you're the source of pathology and malevolence, but everyone else is pretty, you know, innocuous or relatively, you know, benign and benevolent. But there's something about you, you know, that's innately or that you've been trained to be, you know, like violent and dangerous and shit like this. Like, it's like, I think the way it's termed, it's like you're a rat. Not like in the snitch sense, but it's like you're a bug or something like that. Like when motherfuckers see you, They tense up and shit. Like, you ever seen a roach crawling on the floor? Nigga, that's you.
Yeah. You look like a pit viper. That's what you are. You're a pit viper.
Or a dog that's unleashed. You're an unleashed dog.
Like, oh, shit. See the size of that motherfucker?
Or somebody with a, you know, like, with a frowning, you know, face that, like, you, when you confront them in public, you walk on the other side of the street. That's how motherfuckers see you. So my thoughts about it are this. Both whites and blacks are implicated in moral and social wrongdoing. Everybody engages in wrongdoing, okay? But the dominant narrative with white folks, if you want to just look under the lens of race, they shift blame primarily to black folks, but particularly to black men. Especially after Reconstruction. Because the image of black men prior to Reconstruction was like Uncle Ben, for the most part. The eyes were watching God. You got these niggas eating watermelon and chicken singing Negro spirituals on the plantation. Part of the family. Docile, I couldn't hurt a fly. Hey, doing that, Miss Daisy.
You're never allowed to be a man. You damn sure can't be upset or angry. Don't you be angry at that man. You know, we gonna have them good times, okay? Now sit here and eat this chicken, boy. It's safe over here.
So, the first thing I try to do is establish when it comes to, like, how we get dumped on is that, you know, you attribute the sins of one group onto another, especially when both are implicated in the same or similar actions. That's dumping to me.
Mm-hmm.
You attribute the sins of one group onto another, especially when both are implicated in the same or similar actions. There it is. So there's shared guilt. But then you get narratives of innocence, or you get narratives of superiority. Like when it came to white folks, they used narratives that painted them as the upholders of virtue. Particularly the virtue of white women.
Oh boy.
And thereby they were able to sidestep their own culpability in the sexual assault of men and women during slavery. But they have to protect white women's virtue, but they didn't protect black women or men's virtue. But of course, white supremacy needs a victim to protect. And white women were the quintessential victim. So in essence, I agree with this. Like, I don't know if you watched Arami Osei Frimpong, but like recently he came up with a video and he talked about how like white women in the United States are infantilized. But because white women are infantilized, all women by proxy are infantilized in the United States.
I think that one, it makes me chuckle to see how white people can be on this virtue signaling, even though they are the people who go around us, who have a long, detailed history of exterminating people or enslaving them.
Oh, for sure. Now, I mean, look, everybody does something. Look, they got a history of being some violent, rapacious people. Okay? I remember one time I was doing a directed reading course with a Roman Catholic priest. And he wanted to take a graduate seminar with just me. He and I were having conversations about race. And he just wanted to know more about the subject because he has a parish where some of the people are black. And, you know, at least I can credit him with trying to learn more. Okay. And one of the things he said about like white people, especially, you know, like middle class to lower middle class white people, he was like, man, you're talking about like German barbarians, man. What do you think the Anglos are? Yeah. And the Saxons are. And, you know, like the Goths are, and the Visigoths, and the Ostrogoths. Like, what do you think is the internal culture of these groups of people, man, over time? These people will fucking murder you and spit out blood, man. So, I mean, at the end of the day, you know, like, they are violent people, man. But of course, you know, it's been sublimated within this culture. You know, they get to say that, like, we're the ones who are savages, even though they go around the world behaving savagely. But under the veneer of civilization and progress, they'll murder motherfuckers. They'll mass murder people in the name of progress. But I digress. So another thing to me that's dumping, as I said before, it's a form of false purification. And you get cleansed of your own sins by projecting them onto other people. So when it comes to white people, they project by cleansing them of themselves of their own sins by putting them on the blacks. Now the black man is the rapist, whereas the white man is a civilizer, like he wasn't a rapist. All you got to do is look at the phenology not the phrenology. Look at the phenotypes of black folks, and you can tell that there was white rape that took place. It's fucking, it's obvious. But it's false purification. You get to clean yourself of your sins, cleanse yourself of your sins by projecting them onto other people. That co-aligns with my idea of dumping, because it's false purification. And then what it does is, like, one can argue justice work, especially in the contemporary arena, it's all about smashing binaries and doing away with the kind of binaries that Kimberly Crenshaw talked about in the paper, where she was like, they're antinomies of thought, like, about black folks and white folks. So on the one hand, you have like she drew a comparison between industrious lazy, intelligent unintelligent, moral immoral, knowledgeable ignorant, enabling disabling culture, law abiding criminal, responsible shiftless, virtuous pious lascivious. So one could argue that these people, even feminists, do this. Like, they claim to be destroying binaries, but what they end up doing is they end up reifying the binaries they say they're getting rid of, which I find ironic. All you're doing is inverting the binaries. You're not doing away with the binaries, you're inverting them. So now, instead of women being bad, the men are bad. It's not a neutral, like, well, anybody has the potential to be bad. Now you're just, in a Nietzschean move, you're just changing place, you're changing placeholders. Which I don't think that's a form of justice. I think it's a form of reification. So, I mean, there's a lot to it, but I ain't gonna go into it much more, man. Look, I gave y'all the opportunity to come up and holler at your boy, man. I know this is not, it's not a popular subject, because it's not something in popular culture that you could talk about in a fun way. But it is part of popular culture, though, because, like, that's what was used. Intersectionality is used. Okay. But I want you to know, go ahead.
I was going to say, before I get out of here, I don't mind subjects like this, because obviously you have to learn. And I talk about subject matter like this a lot with my friends, and I talk about, look, this is how negative connotations about people start. They start because of the academia a lot of times. And if you don't have the information or the knowledge to challenge that thought, you're going to play victim to it yourself. Always a pleasure, GG.
For sure, man. Peace out, my brother. Hey, look, I just got these groceries. I did put them in the refrigerator and the freezer, though, but I know one thing. Today, man, I got me some, I know what I'm going to eat, man, on my way to bed. I know I'm going to eat these Zatarain's, this blackened chicken, man, and noodles, this blackened chicken pasta. That shit fire, boy. You should try that. I'm about to smash that shit. And then drink me a Muscle Milk, man, and lay my ass down and get ready to go to the gym in the morning, man. That's what I'm about to do. But, man, I appreciate y'all dropping by and hollering at your boy. I ain't going to do nothing tomorrow. I'll probably do something Thursday and Friday. It probably won't be about Kimberly Crenshaw for another week, though, because after a certain period of time, this shit gets redundant. You need time off of it. But, again, you know, I'm going to clip this video. I think what I'm going to do is keep the live and put it behind a paywall. And then I'll take the video, the portion where I'm just reading, and, make a different video. And then that just be like something that, like, is in a regular spot where everybody can see it. But, like, yeah, I think that's what I'm going to end up doing. Because I want people to have access to the information, even people who kind of, like, are not members of the manosphere. Everybody should have access to the paper so they can know what the position is. I think I'll provide the public utility by having done that. He said, no Muscle Milk, get premier protein. Tell me why I need that, man. Hey, man, who, explain that, man. Holler at me and tell me why I need to do that as opposed to Muscle Milk. I need to know why I need to do that. Chris Thomas says this is the first step in politics understanding. I think so. I just want you to know what the viewpoints are, as opposed to like secondary information. Because like you get people will interpret, like, don't take my word for it. Look at what she says, and draw your own conclusions. And I'm trying to provide you or facilitate, you know, the grounds for which you can make up your own mind and develop your own opinions about the source material. That's what I'm trying to do. But I see T Fitness, man. I mean, you might be not disposed right now. You might not be able to talk T Fitness, but I want to know why, you know, like, what's wrong with Muscle Milk, dog, for real, though, if you could tell me. Because I was taking some protein, you know, called, what's the name of that shit, man? Carnivore. I know Marcus like that shit, keep it 100, like it. My body don't like that shit, bro. It doesn't like it. So I think I'm about to go back with the shit I know that, like, my body, it doesn't have an objection to. Some shit called, what's the name of that shit? First form. That's it. My body loves first form. No problems whatsoever. What's up, man? What's good, T?
All right, brother. So, as far as a protein or protein drink, Muscle Milk is a terribly adulterated, protein. It does not allow you to cleave off enough of the amino acids. It's not made for performance. It used to be, but it was bought by, you know, the major cereal company. I'm not going to say the name. And they made
right,
it,
right.
They degraded it terribly.
Oh, man.
So you're not getting you're getting a lot of the waste product of the milk and then not enough of the amino acids that are readily available. So stuff like Premier Protein and Lean Body are still a much more available source of protein. We call it protein efficiency rating, the PER. So it's not efficient. It's, you might as well just have milk with Muscle Milk.
Damn.
All right. So that, yeah. So the it's a lot of things when it comes to digestion, cleaving off protein. So it's not a big deal. It's not going to kill you. I mean, if you have any protein powder of a different source and you just want to get rid of your Muscle Milk, just make yourself like a milkshake with it.
Right.
You dig what I'm saying? Just for a different flavor and taste. But yeah, don't continue to get those ready to drink Muscle Milks.
Yeah, I feel you. Yeah. I mean, you look, that's why we got, you know, brothers here in the space, man, to give information, you know, like, but you did suggest something called Premier.
Premier Protein, which is a ready to drink, and it's like Muscle Milk. It's available typically in CVS and Walmart and stuff like that. So you get your hands on it quick. You don't have to go to a vitamin shop or a GNC to get it.
But it's better. But it's definitely better than.
The protein efficiency rating is way better. Yep.
Damn, I would never have known, man.
That's only because, and that's only because the big cereal company bought Muscle Milk. So you know what happens when shit go commercial sometimes. They make more money, they have a bigger profit margin by cutting corners.
Yeah.
They're buying a name, you know. It's like the cereal protein bars. You wouldn't get a Special K protein bar.
Right. I would never have known, man. And I just I don't drink it like after workouts or anything like that. I just drink it at night. I drink one of them at night before I go to bed because I figure it's slow digesting. It's not
I know when I heard that's what you said you were doing. That's why I specifically said that.
Right. But I definitely would never take Muscle Milk as a post-workout or pre-workout drink. It's just
if you would drink, you add that in the yogurt just to get the calories in. It's just empty calories. So
you're right, man.
So it's not going to be performance enhancement. Not going to be restorative like a real good protein.
Now I'm gonna tell you what I'm gonna tell you the best shit that I've ever had. But like I haven't bought it in so long, but I think I'm gonna buy me I'm gonna buy some of this shit. It's called let me show it to you, man. I don't know if you ever heard of it. Let me share the screen here.
Carnivore?
No, this shit right here, First Form.
First Form. A lot of people love First Form.
Man, yep. Like the people who make it, like, are in the Midwest, and they have like some shit called the Supplement Superstore there.
Yeah.
And bruh, when I tell you this shit is good, it never gave me any gastrointestinal problems.
There you
ever,
go,
man.
There you go. These people, yeah. First Form. A lot of people love First Form, and that's you know, when you're competing or you know getting ready for a show, you have to be careful, or you have to be careful with your GI tract. So First Form is definitely a you know, any one of these that you find at specialty vitamin stores, 90% of them are going to do what they say they're going to do. But the supermarket brand stuff, no good. Except for Premier, which is still good. But your best bet would be to just order more of that.
Yeah, I'm just going to... And then also they got something called Ignition sometimes that, you know, they suggest. It ain't nothing but glycogen, like powdered glycogen.
Yeah.
I don't, you know, that's you just, it's, yeah, you don't need it. But
glycogen, but I mean, honestly, if you just did, you know, like a raw honey or something like that, any kind of glycogen, you know, that, especially when you're working out, you know, your glycogen stores get depleted when you train hard, and if you train hard enough, and I think I'm assuming that you do, because you said you came from, your pops is a pretty active brother, so I'm assuming you're a tough brother too. A lot of that stuff is, you know, the glycogen and the carbohydrate source after the workouts are not going to be as important for you to be special as is the protein.
Right. I
get
it.
Special
because
we
got enough.
Yeah, specialty carbs are very.
No, I was gonna say like a lot of us get more carbs than we need anyway.
Oh, without a doubt, especially after we get older.
So I get it. And not only that, when it was suggested for me to take this shit, I was looking to gain, you know, look to gain weight at the time, but I ain't looking to gain no weight.
You could just eat. Yeah, you just eat. Yeah, so I feel you. I know exactly where you are, man. We in the big 5-0 category. So you just don't want to. We don't want to put that fat on.
Yeah, fuck all that fat, man. Like, you know that, and you know, as you get older, it becomes more difficult for you to get rid of it. You know,
tell me something. So. I don't know, but yeah. So that's that. But yeah, wonderful. Topic of discussion today, Crenshaw. It's so funny because this dovetails in. I just finished reading Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, and it's basically a socialist manifesto. But his hatred for the for black people is so apparent and vivid in this book. It's unbelievable. And this is a story about class conscious and it's like I said, it's a socialist manifesto.
Yeah, so. And that's why, you know, like I think Kimberly Crenshaw is right when she talks about social racial ideology being like a constitutive part or a constitutive. I don't know how to. I mean, I butcher that word quite often, but I think she's right when she says that, you know, like race is baked into the, you know, Western, but particularly American culture.
Yeah.
And we act, you know, we have a veneer like of politeness and anti-discrimination law where we just like, we ignore that it actually is there, but it's, mm-hmm. it's in a more pernicious form because it's not, it's like, which disease do you like the best? The one that like announces that it's fucking trying to kill you, or the sleeper cell that's in your body that's doing all kind of fucking damage. Right?
Correct.
But it's not even, you don't even know it's killing you.
Yeah. They insidious, right? It's much more insidious than one would know. And, you know, and of course, you know, I think that Crenshaw's you know, especially what you read today, she clearly, you know, what in these academic settings, when she was in those academic settings, was able to draw, you know, was able to kind of figure out how to articulate why is it that she and her ilk are not being treated like the same leftist socialists. This is all this is again, a great form of solipsism, because it forced her to put together something very strong, very thorough and constructive. But and I like the fact that I have to say that she was able to use a person like Thomas Sowell to bounce off, you know, these ideas, you know, the one of the other insidious ways of how the shift in the talk is. And because it's my lifestyle now, you know, that, you know, I have clients, you know, from all walks of life, particularly from the Asian community. And people keep saying that, you know, people keep thinking that this anti-Black misandry, you know, is only involves what we call white and Black. It's not bifurcated, man. It's almost us against everybody.
Yeah,
it's us against everybody.
I think she's right about Thomas Sowell, though. I think, you know, I just think she's right about it. Like, you know,
100%.
I think, you know, especially in this paper, I mean, the idea is that you just substituted racial inferiority for cultural inferiority. And then you disconnect the ways in which Black culture is connected to slave culture. But then you say, well, that was so long ago. Like, well, motherfucker, like, well, dude, you never repaired the situation. Like, you never even made an attempt to repair it. And now
this
you just like.
He has an active YouTube page that you could just do a series of reactions on his active YouTube page to this day. It is, he's worse now than he's ever been.
Well, you know, man, you can't teach an old dog new tricks, man.
I'm just saying, for young people are starting to believe him because he's so articulate. And you know, you talked about John McWhorter and Glenn Lowry. You know, those two, you know, are kind of different. I think Glenn Lowry's more, you know, you can really, there's some room to wiggle with Glenn Lowry. But
yeah,
Thomas Sowell has gotten worse.
Well, the funny thing, like Glenn Lowry used to mind being a trap, nigga. That motherfucker used to smoke crack and kick it. You know what I'm saying? That motherfucker Manly Berry type guy. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah, I know.
He can't, bruh. Like, nigga, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'll holler. Like, he on some nigga shit. He can get on some nigga shit real quick if he wants to.
It's so funny how you guys are able to mention Manny Marable, Glenn Lowry. These guys come from the same milk. You know, on the left end of the structure, you know, Democracy Now, Amy Goodman, Bernard White, back in the early 90s, that was kind of my circle of things that I was into once I got out of like all of the Black consciousness movement. I got more into the left movement. And then
just had to
bounce from there once I started to see that this is, you know, this is all a circular bullshit. I'm telling you, what you brothers are doing, what BGS did by bringing the people into the space is the greatest form of awakening for Black men since, like, you know, I'm gonna say it as I always do, since the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, you know.
Oh,
woke
man,
Black
that's too
that.
Well, I'm not going, bro. I'm not going to put myself in that
I'm
category.
No. I'm just saying we lived so many years with that knowledge, it became recycled, right? But it was a missing piece. The missing piece, they never dealt with intersectional politics properly. They never did. And they were repeating many of the talking points of the gynocracy for many years. Even the young boys up until about 3 years ago, until I started, you know, commenting on their asses and saying, stop pandering. You know, and putting Black men down to elevate, you know, XYZ. So now you even seeing some of the young brothers from the Nation expose some of this, you know, anti-Black misandry coming from our women. But it was you brothers who made this possible. Had not been for you, this, you brothers including Tommy Curry. This wouldn't have the shift wouldn't have happened. This Kirk Franklin documentary wouldn't have happened.
Yeah. I feel like, just like I said, Crenshaw, like, she would have positioned herself there. Somebody, if it wasn't her, it would have been somebody else like her.
Without a doubt, we saw.
So I think that, you know, like, the situations we're going through and like, our ability to because women aren't the only people who have the ability to think about and reflect on their experiences. And I think it's unfair to say that, you know, like, every account up to now has just been like this male experience, you know, like male phenomenology, like women have been left out and all. May be true about white dudes to
but
some
not
degree.
About us.
It definitely hasn't been about us, man. It has
Brother,
not.
I have books written about black pioneers. Half the damn book is women. In the frontier, in the West. Half is women. We've always had a reverence for what we as a people did together, men and women. But it wasn't, I'm telling you, when you read the Combahee River Collective manifesto on screen, brother, when you put that in the public record, it's like everything changed for me. It was like when Dr. David Banner got exposed to gamma rays.
Oh, damn, not the gamma rays, but
I'm like, they've been doing this at that level, highly educated women came with a plan against us all the way back in 1974, 1980. And because you brothers are from the academy, not realizing that it trickled down like that, because I graduated from a predominantly white institution, so I never got involved in women's studies or Africana studies, but you guys were seeing it, man. I didn't know it was like that.
A fish doesn't understand water. Cause, you know, like, it's like you don't notice the air. But I'm pretty sure a fish, like, understands all different kinds of variations of air. Yeah. like while it's in it. You know what I'm saying? Like, cause that's not its natural habitat. So I'm pretty sure, like, if there's strong air, like strong wind blowing, it's gonna be like, God damn, this, you know, versus still air or hot air or cool air. It's the same, like, with, you know, like a black man in the academy. Like, you, this is natural, man. You got to engage in self-reflection and start to ask questions like, does this fit up or match up to my own experience? I know what people are telling me. I know what they're saying. I should think.
I mean, it was the other way for me. It was, I was living the experiences that you brothers are talking about, but I thought it was just me. Man, my first wife and a group of her girls were taken in Syracuse, and they were kind of funneled through a system, an inroad system, to get them educated. You know, they were, you know, singled out, you know, and I just thought, oh, girl, you know, sisters doing it. Never understanding her brother didn't have that opportunity.
This is why I say,
yeah,
like, we got experiences too. And what hasn't happened up to this point is for us to be sharing our own experiences. It's just been them sharing their experiences, and they've been validated by certain institutions in the society because it performs some sort of function. I mean, for white folks. And I think in particular, it performs the demonizing function, or the, you know, the boogeyman function of black men, which the society is already committed to. I mean, like, even James Baldwin basically said it. Ishmael Reed has said it. Like, black women like Brenda Verner have said it. Women like, you know, Frances Cress Welsing has said it. I mean, like, there's been so many people who've said it.
Shahrazad Ali has said it. You know, those voices were, that's because for a good time, and you have to attest to this. All we were thinking about was the Black collective, and we were not thinking about, you know, how we were being torn apart by gender. You know, we growing up as Gen Xers were concerned about, you know, what is it, you know, when will this gangbang culture end that the dominant culture is trying to sell us? When are the brothers going to realize that they want us walking around with our pants hanging down? So all became, even those of us who had a voice, it all became reflecting on mostly the male problem, even though we were going through personally some of the things that would be really, like you said before, insidious and cause a lot of problems, which is, you know, some people paternity fraud, some people parental alienation, not getting opportunities to work because the women in your own community discriminate against you like they might as well be a Klansman.
Yeah, but look, I mean, look. So the thing that, like, I study this shit like motherfuckers study the Bible, you know what I'm saying? So, like, the thing she says, the second sentence she says in the first paragraph, drawing from the strength of shared experience, women have recognized the political demands of millions speak more powerfully than the pleas of a few isolated voices. This is why the manosphere is dangerous to some motherfuckers, you know what I'm saying? Like, it just is what it is. Because to them, it's like, hold on, wait a minute. You have the niggardacity to start talking about what you're going through and not just acknowledging what we tell you we're going through?
And it's consciousness raising. They know it. They know what we're doing because they did it. It's
exactly.
Consciousness raising.
That's
if you
exactly
go back to
is.
Step, watch the Stepford Wives back in the day, those women were sitting in circles doing consciousness, women conscious raising groups.
But they don't want us to do it because I'm going to tell you, look, for one, they want you to buy into their own ideology, even though they say that they're like moving past it. Like everybody needs to. This is why I say, if you're a critical theorist, which I think feminists are, they're committed to critical theory. But you can't critique without being amenable to critique. And I think that their fatal flaw is they've never been checked. They don't have to do any critical self-reflection because, in essence, what they're doing is dumping. And let me just say this. Let me put this article up here. I'm going to share the screen one last time. Then I'm about to close this out and land this plane because we've been here for 3 hours. But if you look at this, look. Feminist activists have played a central role in forwarding, and this is the first footnote, right? In forwarding an ideological and institutional challenge to the practices that condone and perpetuate violence against women. Now, one thing Tommy Curry has done is he went ham against Susan Brownmiller. He was like, man, look, most of her theorization is rooted in racial stereotyping, and it's based upon racist social science. Now, I'm just saying, okay, so like one of the cornerstones of her theorization is Susan Brownmiller, which, you know, Curry is like, I'm going after the people. And this is what's clever about Curry. Curry's like, well, if I attack you, it's cool at the surface, but like, I need to figure out, I'm not just going to hit you on your breastplate, on your armor.
No.
I'm going to fucking hit your vital organs because I'm trying to figure out, I want to find out where you got the source of your information from and get at it. To point out the weaknesses in what
verbatim.
You're saying.
He talked about how they took these things verbatim from not just Susan Brownmiller, but he named a myriad of white phrenologists
So I mean, Curry's on the shit though. Like, but at the end of the day, all I'm saying is, it's just a laundry list of white women and shit.
Yes.
I mean, no disrespect, against our will. You know, like Loreen M.G. Clark and Deborah Lewis, Rape, the Price of Coercive Sexuality. All she's doing is what a fucking academician normally does. Take as many sources as you can take that confirms your opinion to some degree or another, even if the views are not absolutely coherent, at least they share in common they synthesize around the idea that like women are subjected to violence and rape. Okay. And but what's obvious to me is that they are.
Yes.
But the problem is that they're not the only one. So I take umbrage with the idea that there's something unique about women and violence and men's desire to commit violence against women, as if violence isn't everyone isn't subjected to it. That's the only issue I got.
It's a shell game, brother. It's a three-card Monty. It's they hide the information that they don't want you to see, and they put a spotlight on what they want you to see. They magnify what they want you to see. And it's been happening to us so much as men, as black men, that we, you know, that they can find, you can find infinite amount of sources of bad behavior for the brothers. And for some reason, the dominant culture is starting to allow these sisters to be the spotlight on their bad behavior too. It's interesting. Something's going on. But you did a wonderful job.
So the one thing I don't want to do is I don't want to dump on any other group, because I think like reverse dumping. Mm. I'm not gonna say that like black men ain't out here doing some fucked up shit, because they are.
Correct.
But don't act like you motherfuckers. Like, that's why I always quote Andre 3000 when he say, "Roses. I know you like to think your shit don't stink, but you lean a little bit closer to see roses really smell like boo boo." Like, your ass stink too. You on some bullshit too.
Correct.
You know, and that's correct. Why they came up with that "Sorry, Miss Jackson." Like, look, man, I'm trying to, you know, do something different than, you know, I want to see your support bra, not support you, motherfucker. I ain't trying to do all this old picking the kitties up and all this shit. I choose you, baby, and all this. Look.
You're right. It's you're trying to, you know, in one way, level the playing field, even the hand. And it's a warning sign. It becomes a warning sign for many of us who have sons and daughters. You know, I have or both. And it gives us something to talk about. You know, we talk about these things to our children. I have a son that's married who has a child. I talk to him about this stuff. Talk to my daughter about how she has to move forward in the world. But I'm not going to warn my daughter against predation and the road to perdition and not warn my sons, right? You got to be able to show them, hey, man, this can happen to you. And hey, babe, this can happen to you. Please be careful. And so that's why you play even. You're helping. It helps in so many ways to show all of this stuff. So thank you, brother, so much.
Hey, man, thank you, man. Appreciate you, man. Thank you for coming on, man, and telling me about this this different protein. I will forever pick it over the sweet ass tasting muscle milk, man.
And both of them are sweet, but they're pretty sweet too. So just so you know, no more muscle milk. It's just detrimental to what you're trying to accomplish.
For sure. Appreciate that, man. Right. Thank you, man.
Peace.
Appreciate it.
Peace.
So look, y'all, man, I'm about to close this out. You'll probably end up seeing me clip this video. I'll probably end up taking this video and putting it behind my membership wall, but leaving, because I want the part of Crenshaw's discussion to be isolated and on its own, and my commentary about it to be, you know, standalone, because I don't want it to jade people's, you know, opinion about her work. Like, you can form your own opinions based upon, you know, your own covering and assessing of a work, you know, itself. So having said all that, man, I'm about to go ahead and cook this food, man, and lay on back, man, and, you know, I just got this new program, man. It's a, hold on. God damn it. Hold on. Hello? Hello? Yes.
Hey, Lee, it's Lori. Hey, did someone commit suicide on our street today?
Someone did a what? Not Lori?
One of my friends texted me, and she said that somebody committed suicide on our street today.
Oh, fuck no, man. I had no idea.
You didn't see no cops, did you?
No, not at all. I've been here all day. I haven't seen any police. I haven't seen any ambulances. I haven't seen anything.
Yeah, she said that. Well, she said Lake Road. I said, well, I don't live on Lake Road. I live off of Lake Road. She said, right by the laundromat and stuff, right? And I'm like, well, yeah. She said that road. I'm like, yeah. Because, I mean, shit.
I ain't seen nothing, Lori. You know, I seen you like later on this evening too. If I'd have seen it, I'd have told you. You feel me? I haven't.
Oh yeah, I know. I was just like thinking maybe you saw cops and you just didn't know what it was, maybe. But
I ain't seen a cop. I ain't seen an ambulance. I've seen nothing. I haven't even seen a large amount of people pulled outside to see anything. You know what I mean? So.
Man, I hope not, because there's like, I know there's people on the street like. You know, one guy, him and his girlfriend broke up, and then another girl that, remember them creepy drug dealers? Like, they're disappeared.
So the white,
everybody. Like, man, I hope
the white rednecks.
Oh, that makes me feel bad if it was. I hope not.
Yeah, man. All I can say is I haven't seen anything, man. You know, I'm just quiet. You know how I get down, yeah. Lori. I ain't seen nothing. If I saw somebody hurting themselves or, you know, if I could have helped in that capacity, I would have helped them. You know what I mean? But I.
You know what's crazy? Do you want to hear something super crazy?
Go ahead.
Last night, I was on the front porch just for a minute. I was just out there, I don't know, turn the hose off, and I was standing on the porch. And I saw some guy walking down the street, like our way, and he was on his phone. He was just talking to somebody. And while he's walking, I heard this giant boom. Did you hear that yesterday?
Not at all.
It sounded like a freaking shotgun, but it sounded like it was coming through the woods.
Damn.
Like, you know, like through the woods, because sometimes you hear gunshots, or could have been something like a little explosion. Who knows? And I remember that guy was walking with his phone, and he was like, ducked real quick. He's like, shit, you know, and then, you know, he just kept walking, and everything was fine. I hope the hell that wasn't somebody killing themselves, man.
Hey, man, you know, it's, you know, the moving finger rights and having writ, it's already done. It's etched in stone. Can't take that one back. If somebody did it, you know, I would have tried to talk them out of it, man. You know, like, life is too precious, man, you know. Can't,
but, don't. I mean, yeah, I know, but I wonder if that sound was like, I don't know what a shotgun would sound like coming from somebody's house like that. It was a big gun, whatever. If it was I'm pretty sure it was a giant gun. Because, you know, I heard that guy get them 14 shots that night. That kid way down the street got shot.
Yeah, hey, man. Rural America, man. Rural America, man.
Well, it's just, it is worse. It wasn't like this. It didn't used to be like this. Everybody wasn't going crazy, man. We're just crazy now.
Rural America. But hey, look.
Yeah, I think you know what I think it is? I think it's these damn cell phones. All this internet and cell phones, and people are depressed, and all these kids are thinking they need to be millionaires. You know? Everybody stepped away from life. Everybody thinks they need to be rich, and they need their money now. Blah, blah, blah.
By the way, man, you know, you got an extra $500,000 you can loan me?
Oh, shit. What happened?
I'll say $500,000. You didn't hear me, did you? No, I'm just talking shit, man. I'm being silly, shit, man. You got a cool million sitting around. I'll take it off your hands. Yeah,
I'm not right.
Anyway, man, I'll talk to you later, Lori. I'm in the middle of something right quick.
All right, take care, man.
All right,
bye.
Bye. That's my neighbor, man. You know what I'm saying? But anyway, my bad, man. I ain't even mean to expose y'all to that. She just called me. I thought she was about to tell me that it was groceries left outside. And then she saw him on the porch, and I should talk about some motherfucker that twisted they self, which, unfortunate, man, you know. Shit get like that sometimes for some folks, man. But anyway, you know, that's my white next-door neighbor, man, Becky. But anyway, man, she cool. She I fuck with her. She looks out for me and shit. But anyway, man, y'all be good, man. Y'all be peaceful. I'll holler at y'all on the next one, you know what I'm saying? So, I don't know what I'm going to talk about next, man. I think I'm going to put a pause on Kimberly for a minute, you know what I'm saying? And then get down with the, you know, get down probably next week, man. You know what I'm saying? Of course, I'm going to do the short bus shit. So, anyway, man, y'all be good, bruh. I'll holler at y'all on the next one, man. Peace out.